We are about to start the 7th Anuradha Ghandy Memorial Lecture program. Thank you, all of you, for making it. And I will begin by introducing a small introduction on the Anuradha Ghandy Memorial Lecture. Anuradha Ghandy was our dear comrade, friend, who left us at a very young age, 54, in the year 2008, April 12th, when she was snatched from our midst and from the revolutionary work that she was doing due to an unexpected illness. In her memory, and in order to remember all that she stood for, all that she worked for throughout her life, we formed a committee of friends and comrades of Anuradha Ghandy from Maharashtra, mostly from Bombay, but also from Nagpur, where she worked for more than a decade. And the committee, despite many constraints, has succeeded in holding an annual lecture. We've had speakers like Samir Amin. The very first lecture in 2008, Samir Amin himself. Samir Amin had delivered the lecture. And we've had Baburam Bhattarai, we've had Jan Mirdal, Arundhati Roy, and last year Uma Chakravarti. And this year, for the 7th Anuradha Ghandy Memorial Lecture, we have with us Meena Kandasamy. Now, to understand Anuradha's range of work, we had also brought out a publication, Scripting the Change, which was a collection of Anu's writings over 3 decades. And all those who have gone through the book will know that she was not a unidimensional person or activist or intellectual. Her writings specialized on the field of caste, and Anuradha is credited for having brought into the revolutionary discourse the understanding on caste as a basis for bringing about revolutionary change in our country. And her writings brought about a necessary focus to clear a lot of misunderstanding created by the establishment, that those who stand with the revolution or revolutionary forces, they neglect caste, and those who work for caste emancipation, they are opposed to leftist Marxist thinking. Anuradha's writings contributed a significant amount in bridging the gap, in clearing much of the misunderstandings in this field. She also contributed a great deal in an understanding of feminism, and her constant approach was right from the time in the 80s when the feminist movement took root and radical feminism grew in India, to always engage in all the debates and bring a Marxist focus to the feminist discourse. And last but not least, Anuradha also played a major role in the field of culture. She was one of the founding members of the All India League of Revolutionary Culture. She wrote about the importance of bringing about a cultural change in order to tackle the feudal, the various social inequalities which are prevalent in India. So in Meena Kandasamy, I would say that we have a speaker who is a radical feminist, who has taken on the caste establishment and is also recognized as a literary person of her own merit. In fact, she's in Bombay as one of the panelists at the Tata Literary Festival, and so she is the author of a book, The Gypsy Goddess, in which she has covered the judicial hypocrisy and the judicial, or what one could call the lack of accountability of those who perpetrate caste atrocities and caste massacres in our country, which started with the Kilvenmani massacre in Tamil Nadu, and she has traced what happened in the proceedings, in which after 2 decades or so, all the perpetrators were acquitted. And we find the same pattern being followed in each caste atrocity after the other. For example, after the Kilvenmani massacre, the massacre of Dalits in Karamchedu in 1985, in Tsundur in 1991, in Bathani, Tola in 1996, Laxmanpur, Bathe in 1997, Mianpur in the same year, Nagri Bazaar in 1998, Shankar Biga in 1999, and the toll is rising. In the present dispensation, as you know, lynchings have become the order of the day. In the present Modi fascist state structure that we have today, daily you hear of Dalits being killed, Muslims getting lynched. I must just share with you that just yesterday, there was a demonstration outside the Toyota showroom in Cotton Green, in the heart of a city like Bombay, where a Muslim worker whose name was Yaqub Sheikh, he got brutally killed in a manner unimaginable, in a manner unthinkable, where in a showroom, an air pipe was inserted into his rectum and air was released at a pressure of 140, because of which his insides burst. And the management and the police are today spinning a story of a prank gone wrong, because the establishment, the media, all are talking about lynchings which happen in the badlands of Uttar Pradesh, but you cannot visualize such a thing happening in the heart of Bombay. But this is becoming the order of the day. So in order to focus on all these issues, we have with us Meena Kandasamy. I invite her to come to the stage. I would also like to thank Kumud Shanbag, Anuradha's dear mother, who is in our midst, who has taken the trouble, despite her ill health, to be part of this program. And I give a special thanks for her presence. And her brother Sunil Shanbag, Anuradha's brother Sunil Shanbag, is with us. He will say a few words. I request him to come and say a few words before we introduce, before Meena gives her lecture today. Sunil.
Yeah. First of all, a special thanks to the Anuradha Ghandy Memorial Committee for conducting this event so successfully and with such commitment and warmth over the last over 7 years. We as the family really haven't been able to make it every time, but we're always touched by the efforts that have gone into this. Special thanks to Meena Kandasamy for being here and so graciously agreeing to speak. I personally got to know of your writing when I chanced upon a collection of your poems, Miss Militancy, a couple of years ago. And then I realized that, you know, with your writings, I read a little bit more about what you've written and some of your interviews. And it was very interesting for me because you seem to straddle the world of, you know, literature, culture and politics. And then in one interview, I read that you had in some manner been inspired by Anuradha, and it was wonderful because it was almost like two worlds had come together for me. So thank you very much for being here, and of course thank you all for coming to listen and be part of this. Just a couple of things that I want to talk about, especially in the context of Meena's being here, and her persona is really as a cultural figure as much as an activist. It's also significant, I think, because of the historical moment that we are in here. I think Susan mentioned that to a certain extent, the kind of atmosphere that we are in, the particular point in history that we are holding this memorial lecture. You know, some of us learned our theater, and you might say our art and our understanding of culture in the late 70s in this city. And it was quite interesting for us to understand over a period of time that as much as it was futile to try and make a distinction between form and content in art, it was equally futile to separate culture and politics, or art and politics. And it's difficult to explain this, but this was a profound moment of insight at that time when you suddenly realized that there were no such distinctions. And I think that happened primarily because that was a time when progressive thought, progressive people, progressive activists, call them what you might, strive to broaden the definition of these ideas. You strive to broaden the definition of politics. Politics went beyond just what was commonly understood as the politics of the state or the political establishment. We talked about gender politics, we talk about politics of relationships, politics of life, really. Similarly, the definition of culture went beyond practice, it really became a way of life. And in such a scenario, it was really difficult to separate the two. And that's how we then proceeded to work, where we believed, and it's natural that you believe that then everything becomes a political act, not in a narrow way, but, you know, in a much broader sense, that whatever you chose to do, however you chose to express yourself became, in a sense, a political act. And I'm only bringing this up because, you know, it's ironical that today what we are seeing is, in fact, you know, the whole thing come a full circle, where the definition of both these terms, both these ideas, have actually been so narrowed the definition of culture that is pushed onto us today is an extremely narrow and banal definition, and so is the definition of politics. Case in point, I mean, whether you call it the resistance of the Film and Television Institute students who have been on strike for a long time to press for certain legitimate demands, or whether it is the protest that the form of protest that has been chosen by a group of writers or filmmakers, all of them, the establishment tries to discredit this by calling these political acts. But this is a political act. And I want to say, yes, of course it is a political act. And I don't see why we should be coy about it. It is a political act, but not political in the sense of today's definition, of the narrowness of that definition, but political in terms of demonstrating that there is an alternative ideology, there is another way of looking at the world which is different from what is being laid out. Looking at a world, looking at a society which we believe has flaws, there is injustice, there is intolerance, call you what it may. I mean, you know, we have plenty of that. And if one takes a political position against that, call it political, doesn't matter. That's what it is. So I think it's really important to reclaim this today. We surrender these spaces, we surrender these ideas very easily and very quickly. And I think we need to be assertive about that. And in doing so, I think people who straddle the world of culture and politics have a special role to play, which is why it's very, very significant that we have Meena Kandasamy speaking here today. I won't take any more of the time. I'm sure we're all looking forward to a very insightful and stimulating evening. Thank you very much.
I'd like to invite Shoma to chair today's session. And after Meena's talk, we'll have a question answer session. I now invite Meena to take the stage.
Good evening, everyone. I cannot find the words to tell you what it means to be here, to tell you what it means to me personally, to speak at a memorial lecture for Anuradha Ghandi. It's something I can never even imagine, because what she was is something that's very aspirational for me. It's something that somebody like me would like to do if I had another life, you know. But I don't know, the kind of sacrifice, the kind of revolutionary spirit that she embodies, the kind of quick way in which she gives up her privilege and goes fighting, I think I mean everybody has an idea of a heroine or an idol, and I think Anuradha comes very close to that for me. And I don't think that personally she don't like that kind of hero worship, but it almost borders on that. So yeah, when I was asked to speak on behalf of the committee, I didn't even believe that the email was a real email. I thought somebody who knows me very well is trolling me by saying, oh, come and speak at this. So I actually wrote back to Anand Teltumde, who invited me and said, is this your real ID? Are you the Anand? And are you really serious about this? So that's the kind of shock that I had. So thanks, everyone. Thanks to Susan, who tried very hard to liaise with me. Thanks to Shoma and to others. I will begin speaking. I have prepared a longer text because for some reason I believe that that would do justice, but I think that for the sake of time, I will skip a few of the portions of my own speech. So we are...
I'm sorry to interrupt, but there will be a translation for those who can't follow English. There's some mic a problem.
Oh, you can't hear. You want me to speak louder? In the past few days, we have been hearing and sharing pictures of the lynching of the two Dalit children in Faridabad, Vaibhav and Divya. And it is something that's very shocking and at the same time very graphic. But I would like to start by telling you that the killing of children is a caste Hindu speciality. Our memories of the Gujarat genocide in 2002, we cannot forget the bodies of small children which is lined up, arranged next to each other. And I think there is a long history of the killing of children. So if you look at the massacre in Kilvenmani that happened on Christmas Day 1968, 23 small children were killed. All of them were burnt to death. In fact, it's not just children who were locked up in a hut were burnt to death, but there is one episode which anybody in memory tells you again and again. And it is the episode of how one of the mothers of the child, in a last desperate attempt to save the child, throws the child outside, hoping that somebody will save, somebody in the mob will have the humanity to save this child. But they basically chopped the baby into pieces and put the baby back in the hut and set the hut on fire. So this is the caste Hindu humanity that we have in this country. And so when we trace the history of massacres, whether it is Villupuram, whether it is Bathani Tola, whether it is Laxmanpur Bathe, let us realize that the killing of children is a watermark that runs through each of these caste atrocities. So even as we are, and even as we grieve, even as we are shell-shocked by this cruelty, let us understand where the caste system comes into play and how it works. I wrote on Kilvenmani and I decided to write about it because it shows not only the cruelty of the caste system but also the cruelty of the state machinery. In Kilvenmani, you have a particular case where the police aid the landlords who lead the lynch mobs. The police also frame a very flimsy case. They water down every testimony and they give plenty of escape routes for the accused to walk away. The politicians, they never take the threat that Kilvenmani will be burnt with the seriousness that it deserves. The Congress party in Kilvenmani in Nagapattinam district is represented by the man who actually lynched the Dalits. So Gopalakrishna Naidu is the president of the Tanjore Congress. The Prime Minister at the time, the Chief Minister of the state at the time, Annadurai, he comes and he says, people should forget this as they forget a feverish nightmare or a flash of lightning. This is India's first Dravidian chief minister who says, and then Periyar, a month later, speaks about the event and he says, wage is not something that you can demand. A wage is that which is fixed by the market conditions. And he blames the communist for the act of Kilvenmani. So when you see the entire state apparatus, when you see the whole political system try to betray the people of Kilvenmani in this manner, then you understand. But I personally, when I read about this case, when I read about how 44 people, men and women and children, were lynched to their death, I was betrayed not by what the caste Hindus did, but what the judgment did. And I felt that the judgment was as merciless as the massacre itself. If we revisit the undivided East Tanjore district in the immediate aftermath of what happened in Kilvenmani, you will find something very interesting emerging. You have all these landlords who go out and who say things like, there will be 100 more Gopalakrishna Naidus, he's the man who basically led this lynch mob, who's the landlord. 100 more Kilvenmanis will continue to burn. And one of those other things they said, 100 landlords are willing to enter the gallows, hundreds of us are ready to embrace the noose. And this is where the twist comes. This is the state of mind of the perpetrators of the massacre, the willingness to face the legal consequences of their action. But then the judiciary steps in and not one landlord is sent to the gallows, no one is imprisoned for life, no one served a life term, and on the contrary, every single one of them is acquitted. So the murderers, as depraved, as cruel, as casteist, as feudal as they are, at least anticipate that they have to face the consequence of their action. They knew that crime would result in punishment. But this is when Kilvenmani massacre takes its important turn, and the judgment in this case marks an important moment in our nation's history because the court sets a dangerous precedent. Today, if a massacre on that scale happens, I think the caste Hindus will go and say, no, we are not going to spend any time in jail, we are going to be set free. And having to, you know, talk about not only this massacre, because Kilvenmani is not just Kilvenmani. Kilvenmani continues to happen all over India. It happens in Kilvenmani in 1968, but it happens in Villupuram in 78. It happens in Tsundur, it happens in Karamchedu, it happens in Bathani, Tola, it happens in Laxmanpur, Bathe. This mass killing of Dalits is something where it happens again and again. And the way in which the judiciary functions, it's also replicated in the same manner. So when I started looking at it, you could find a whole common thread that runs through all these massacres. And the first thing is there's a large element of victim blaming. There is dismissing the evidence of the witness on one pretext or the other. The judiciary being completely unbothered by the fate of the case. The judiciary not stepping in when all the witnesses turn hostile because of the threats that they face. The judiciary not taking any steps to protect them. The denial of the fact that some of these massacres are actually caste atrocities, trying to deny that caste played any role in this. Denial of the class struggle, denying that there was, you know, a fight for wages or a fight for land. And sometimes reducing the entire thing into something about compensation, believing in the most vulgar fashion that the lives of Dalits can be purchased, you know, with some amount of government money. And also how the court often enters and decides what must have happened, deciding what is natural, and also using the victims themselves as a scapegoat for the injustice that it continues to perpetuate. So even if this may sound vague and broad, I think it illustrates the compromised nature of the justice delivery mechanism in this country and highlights how and why our struggle for a revolutionary society must begin not only through an attack on the well-entrenched system of caste or the exploitative nature of capitalism, but the centrality of having to hold the state and its various apparatus responsible for their complicity. And I think the judiciary in this regard is especially an important organ of the bourgeois democratic state because it prides itself on its autonomy and its neutrality, and even when actually it is working only to protect the interests of the ruling classes, which in the Indian context are the dominant caste. So from time to time this judiciary might make the right noises, it can pretend that it's pulling up the government, it can, you know, express the occasional outrage. But if you look at it closer, you will understand the true face of this judiciary. And I think in this context, it's important to, you know, recall a bit of Foucault, who says, the real political task in a society such as ours is to criticize the workings of institutions that appear to be both neutral and independent, to criticize and attack them in such a manner that the political violence that has been exercised obscurely through them will be unmasked so that one can fight against them. And I think there can be no better place to unmask and understand the caste Hindu cruelty of the judiciary than in their attitude towards the 44 murdered victims of Kilvenmani. Let us begin with Kilvenmani. It's very often people compare Kilvenmani to Guernica, to Lidis, to villages that become the symbol of dysfunction. Like the village of Lidis, which was wiped out by the SS in the Second World War, or the Spanish village of Guernica, Kilvenmani symbolizes both the brutality of caste horrors and the heart of resistance that one sometimes stumbles upon in remote, far-flung, off-the-map places. And yet in Kilvenmani, justice failed the people. It's not only the atrocity of Kilvenmani that reincarnates itself, but it's the miscarriage of justice as well. And what happened in Kilvenmani is that 44 Dalits were killed and the Madras High Court acquitted all of them. The Patna High Court repeated this feat in its verdict in the Bathani Tola massacre, where 21 Dalits were killed in 1996. There was an acquittal of all the accused. And in Laxmanpur Bathe massacre, where 58 Dalits were killed in 1997, and there was an acquittal of all the accused. The latest in this hall of shame was the Tsundur massacre of 1991, where 8 Dalits were killed. And in 2014, the Andhra Pradesh High Court let all the accused free. Then followed the incident in Kambalapalli. In August 2014, there was a judgment where the court said they have spent enough time in jail and the evidence is not good and all the witnesses have turned hostile. So again, all the accused were set free. Now coming back to the Kilvenmani judgment, I'm going to read a small excerpt from it. This is from the Madras High Court judgment. It's truly regrettable that the 42 agricultural labourers who sought refuge in the hut of Pandari Ramaya lost their lives because that hut was set on fire. However, it is a little comforting to learn that the accused did not have any intention to burn them to death. In our opinion, the onus of responsibility for the tragic incident that took place on the night of 25 December 1968 lies with the accused, who have to accept the blame. But we regret the fact that we have not found sufficient evidence on record to implicate the accused in this incident. We tried our best to separate chaff from grain to lengthen the punishment for at least a few of the accused, and at the same time to ensure that the witnesses depose in a natural manner. But the subliminal shortcomings of the prosecution, witnesses prevented us from punishing individuals whom we consider innocent. And this is where you have to look at the judgment for the way in which they talk about the little comfort that the court gets, you know, that the accused did not have any intention to burn 44 people to death. I mean, then why did they set a hut on fire? Was it some kind of performance art? I mean, these are questions that the court doesn't answer. Was the court also unaware of the history of the struggle against untouchability that was being waged by the Communist Party in Tanjore district? Were they not aware of the long-waged struggle, the strikes that were taking place in order to demand 6 measures of paddy? And was Kilvenmani not threatened again and again? Gopalakrishnan Naidu, 10 days before the massacre, held a meeting in this village of Kilvenmani. He openly declared that unless the people give up the red flag, unless they give up associating with the communists, unless they join the landlords association called the Paddy Producers Association, he will burn them. But nothing happened. And in fact, what the High Court judgment did, they quoted letters of Gopalakrishnan Naidu, letters that he wrote to the Chief Minister word for word. These were letters in which he claimed that he was being hassled for higher wages. And this was used by the court to prove that Gopalakrishnan Naidu was implicated in this massacre only because he was an enemy of the communist. The testimonies of the many witnesses who saw him at the scene of the crime, the letter of the local communist MLA fearing that Kilvenmani will be burnt to ashes, the many threats and economic boycotts of the village faced, they were all rubbished by the court. And the court also said that the victims, who were all untouchable, who were all Dalits, who were all working class, landless agricultural laborers, the court actually said, the victims and the witnesses have found it difficult to contain the urge to make him the villain of the episode. So the fact that these people were fighting against him was used to show that that's why they were implicating him in a case. And this is where I want to quote Ambedkar, who talks about the impossibility for untouchables to obtain any justice, any protection from the police or from the courts. He says, and I'm quoting Ambedkar, the police are drawn from the ranks of the caste Hindus. The magistracy is drawn from the ranks of the caste Hindus. The police and the magistrates are the kith and kin of the caste Hindus. They share the sentiments and the prejudices of the caste Hindus against the untouchables. As every untouchable will be able to testify, if an untouchable goes to a police officer with a complaint against the caste Hindu, instead of receiving any protection, he will receive plenty of abuse. Either he will be driven away without his complaint being recorded, or if it's recorded, it will be recorded quite falsely to provide a way of escape to the touchable aggressor. If he prosecutes his offenders before a magistrate, the fate of the proceedings can be foretold. The untouchable will never be able to get Hindus as witness because the conspiracy of the villagers not to support the case of the untouchables, however just it may be. If he brings witness from the untouchables, the magistrate will not accept the testimony because he can easily say that they are interested and not independent witness, or that they are independent witness. The magistrate is an easy way of acquitting the accused simply by saying that the untouchable's complaint did not strike him as truthful. He can do this fearlessly, knowing full well that the higher tribunal will not reverse his finding. And if you look again, this idea of the unreliable witness, this idea that the witness was not good enough to punish, has happened everywhere again, you know, not only in Kilvenmani but elsewhere. So all the testimonies of the Dalits are rejected as faulty, unreliable, contradictory, smacking of falsehood, lacking in credibility or a deliberate afterthought. So in the Bathani Tola judgment, where 20 people are killed, where 19 of them are women and children, every witness of the prosecution is taken up and dismissed for one reason or the other. In the Laxmanpur Bathe judgment, we hear the judge telling, I am of the view that the prosecution witnesses are not reliable. Appellants deserve grant of benefit of doubt, which is accordingly granted. This is how, you know, they celebrate a massacre by just letting everybody go. And once again, I come back to the Kilvenmani massacre because I think it is a very dangerous precedent that started to haunt the judiciary and which continues to haunt it today. And again, I quote word for word from the judgment. There is something astonishing about the fact that all the 23 persons implicated in this case should be mirasdars. Most of them are rich men owning vast tracts of land, and it is clear that the first accused, Gopalakrishnan Naidu, possessed a car. Such mirastars might have harbored cowardly thoughts of taking revenge on communist agricultural laborers. However much they might have been eager to wreak vengeance on the peasants, it's unlikely to believe that they would walk bodily to the scene and set fire to the houses unaided by any of the servants. Owning plenty of lands, these mirastars were likely to play safe, unlike desperate, hungry laborers. Anyone would rather expect that the mirastars, keeping themselves in the background, would send their servants to commit the several offences which, according to the prosecution, the mirastars personally committed. This is a class analysis according to the High Court of Madras. The equation that land ownership bestows upon people some divine, compassionate, godly nature. And this is how they analyze a class war that's unfolding. Because, and also please understand that when you talk about class, it's never about class alone in India. It's mostly and almost exclusively about caste. So according to them, the landowning mirastars carry with them the trait of not only the rich but also the dominant caste, who are safe players. And the desperation of the oppressed class renders them capable of doing anything. So even when they are the dead, they are the evil people. The desperation of the oppressed laborers of Kilvenmani, they are not only landless, but they are also untouchable. So it becomes easy to demonize them even in the moment of their death. And let us go back again and look at other judgments, you know. And I'm going to read now, there's a lot of sections that I have taken, but I will read one of the more striking ones. This is from the Bathani Tola judgment. People who were intent to liquidate everybody naturally would have seen that there are no male members. They were searched for male members who were all hiding in close proximity to the village itself. This is unnatural for the prosecution witness. Because of these reasons, we have found the identification made by the prosecution witness not worthy of reliance for the purpose of extreme punishment of either death or life imprisonment. This is delivered on 16th April 2012. So now what is natural and what is unnatural is a category that the judiciary decides. So to kill everyone is natural because the feudal caste Hindu brain of the judiciary cannot accept anything else as the norm. For a mob to specifically kill all male members, because this is what Parasuram did to annihilate the race of Kshatriyas, is once again natural. What is unnatural is that the Dalits manage to survive, they manage to hide, they manage to live to tell their tale. It's unnatural for upper caste men, especially middle-aged men, unlike the young who would not stop to think, to defile themselves through the rape of a Dalit woman. This was the judgment in the Banwari Devi rape case. So anything that's inconvenient, doesn't fit the, you know, caste Hindu male paradigm, becomes an inconvenient. It is so inconvenient that it can only be a lie. And the natural here, the dreadful natural, the natural that is the fantasy and the imagination and the settled tradition of the Brahminical dominant caste judiciary. This is how the justice that is peddled in this country is only a caste justice. And again, when I was reading this judgment about Kilvenmani, there is one of the line that says, to prove that there was no intention to kill everybody, the judge basically, the division bench basically says, only one of the streets was burnt, not all the streets. If they wanted to kill everybody, they would burn all the streets. So why were these streets not burnt? And sometimes when I read these judgments of Bathani Tola, where the judge asks, why were all the men not killed? Or Kilvenmani, where they ask, why all the streets were burnt? I'm happy that these very educated, very respected criminals have been confined to the courtrooms. They're not leading the mobs personally. Because the their rationale of questioning makes one believe that they had the task of a caste massacre been left in the hands of the men who are leading the courts today, they would have done a much more thorough job than feudal caste Hindu militias itself. And once again, when I come back to the judgment about Bathani Tola, you have, at least in a couple of the judgments, the fact of delay, even a delay of 1 or 2 hours, becomes, you know, extrapolated to say that the case lacks merit. So in Bathani Tola, there is a 12-hour delay between the time when this man first sees his family killed and the time he approaches the police. And that is made into an issue to deny justice. And the same thing also happens in Tsundur, where the Dalits are chased for days. They all have to go into hiding. And just the fact that, you know, they did not immediately approach the police, that there was a day's delay or 2 days delay, is used to deny all justice and to say that, you know, the Dalits have built up a case. I'm skipping some of the extensive quotations and I'm coming to see, another thing, and this is the title of the talk, which talks about no one killed the Dalits. And this is where you understand that when the court repeatedly, systematically tells everybody to leave and tells everybody to be is acquitted, let us assume for a minute that the accused are always left off because the court is not convinced of the guilt. And the court cannot implicate these innocent people because they're trapped and victims of the police framing these false cases. What has the court actually done to, you know, pull up the police? Have they ever instituted any inquiry? Have they ordered action against the police who, you know, frame these kind of flimsy cases? Have they tried to hold them responsible in any of these cases? You know, today I was discussing with a friend of mine about what happened in all this and how, you know, this few hours delay, the travesty of injustice that happened in Tsundur, for instance. And there is another, I think everybody should, they should be make it some kind of compulsory reading of this Tsundur judgment to understand how far the courts can go with their open, blatant casteism. So I'm going to read a little. When plain, unrefined injustice is doled out to Dalit people, the courts in this land are aware that such a brutality will not go unchallenged. Knowing fully well that there will be widespread unrest, we see instances of how the long arm of the law takes the right of people to protest illegitimately. Take for instance the High Court of Andhra Pradesh judgment in the Tsundur massacre. The superintendent of police, Guntur Rural, shall also ensure that no celebrations of protest in the village of Tsundur and Modukur on the eve of this judgment take place for at least a period of 3 months, and utmost vigilance is kept on the villages. So after 3 months, the Reddis and the Telagas who perpetrated the massacre can bring out the fireworks. The Dalits can then bring out their loudspeakers and their placards. Celebrations for the caste Hindus, road rokos for the Dalits, and this is the prize distribution ceremony of the Indian judiciary. I'll have a moment for the shock to settle in because of the High Court's heartlessness of equating Reddi celebration with Dalit protest and denying both of them as it were one and the same thing. The Reddis denied the perverse pleasure of gloating over the scandalous act of getting away with the massacre, and the Dalits, the righteous anger, an anger that is to be kept under wrap until the period of silence, the period of outrage, the period of mourning, the miscarriage can pass. Do these courts conveniently forget that the right to protest is a civil right? What else do they do? How else do they barter the injustice? How else do they seek to quell the anger of the oppressed? There is somehow in these state institutions the belief that the rage of the people can be annulled by giving them money. The idea of compensating Adivasis for the forests that are stolen from them, the idea of displacing people to make way for big dams, the idea of taking away the land of the farmers to make way for corporate loot, and in all these cases paying money in exchange for uprooting people. However, it's never only about land or history or the roots of the people. The judiciary, this country, have been following a pattern of establishing that it's normal to not just take land and hand over compensation, but perhaps take a Dalit person's life and pay money in exchange. This is the mentality of the higher judiciary, which somehow believes that monetary compensation will equal the price of injustice that has been meted out upon the Dalits. And this has been the case right from the days of Kilvenmani. I'm pulling out a quote from the miserable Madras High Court judgment. We believe that the dependents of those who lost their lives in the Holocaust will be generously compensated by the government. To cover up for the present travesty of allowing all the accused to walk away scot-free, the judgment of the Madras High Court is dressed up in false sympathy. If this was indeed the Holocaust, where are the Nuremberg trials? Where is your sense of justice? And again, look at the deliberate use of the word Holocaust coming from a criminal justice system which did not even treat the killing of the 44 men, women and children as a murder, but merely as an act of arson, or what the Indian Penal Code calls in its funny language, mischief by fire. Does not the use of the word Holocaust immediately ring a bell? Does it not remind us that these murders of Dalit people are not aberrations that otherwise scar a beautiful India, but that these murders are part of systematic genocide that's unleashed upon the oppressed? Let us come back to this question of money as a replacement for life. This time the disgrace goes to the Patna High Court. And I am quoting directly from the Patna High Court's judgment. I would like to observe that there being no dispute about the factum of death, injury having been caused to 58, 4 members of the weaker sections of the society in village Laxmanpur Bathe on the night of 1 December 1997, the state is obliged to pay compensation to the next of kin of the 58 deceased and the 4 injured from its fund. The amount of compensation is to be calculated by the trial court, taking into account the age, income of the deceased and the injured in light of the sections of section 163A and second schedule of the Motor Vehicles Act 1988. In absence of any documentary proof of any of the victim, trial court will calculate the income of the victim on the basis of minimum wage. This is the flippant offhand manner in which 58 dead people in the Laxmanpur Bathe massacre are treated. Their lives relegated to the sum of money based on minimum wage. Did the court even stop to think about the fact that 4 families were completely, entirely wiped out in that massacre? How do you compensate a horror like that, a horror of having your entire lineage wiped out, the family trees abruptly removed from the face of the earth? And what gall does it take? I really want to know, for the judges of the High Court to treat the death of Dalits on par with the death that takes place in a vehicular accident. How do we come to terms with the triviality and the mockery of justice that a caste Hindu feudal justice system which reduces Dalit lives to such cheapness? And also, I would like to talk about the fact that, you know, when I talk about court, or when I talk about the justice system, it's not only the courts, because in some parts of the country, especially in like Tamil Nadu, it's very common to use the idea of a judicial commission to do exactly what the court does, because judicial commission is a paper tiger. When the judiciary has not directly intervened, it has used the idea of a judicial commission, usually a one-man commission constituted by a sitting judge or a retired judge, to inquire into the happening and come up with recommendation. These judicial commissions have often served to distort the truth of what happened, to criminalize Dalits, to buy time and to serve as a distraction and to defend the abuses of the state. So in the Villupuram atrocity, where 12 Dalits were butchered in broad daylight on 24 and 25 July 1978, and the settlement was set on fire, the Justice Sadasivam Commission was appointed. It's very telling that Sadasivam belonged to the Mudaliar caste, the same caste as the perpetrators of this carnage. Although the victims did not have any trust in this commission, they testified in its presence. All the testimonies were rejected on the flimsiest of pretext. Sadasivam decided to reject the statement, saying that it was either not genuine, a mixture of imagination, and in one case where a non-Dalit man who lived with a Dalit woman testified to what he had seen, and his testimony was sympathetic to the Dalit people, the head of the commission started wondering about the legality of this marriage. So this is the commission. So the, and in the end, when the commission had to come up with its findings, they decided to blame the Dalits as antisocial elements. Similarly, the Justice Mohan Commission that inquired the Manjole massacre in 1997, where the police brutally opened fire and killed 17 Dalit tea plantation workers who were marching to the collectorate to demand higher wages, the commission decided that most of the deaths were due to drowning because the protesters ran in panic and jumped into the Tamarabarani River, and also justified the counter-stone throwing by the police. This commission came up with a bizarre recommendation to ban political rallies in the state, as if the cause of violence was not unbridled exercise of power by the repressive state apparatus, but instead the fact that the workers were claiming their right to take to the streets to demand a fair wage. The Justice Sampath Commission that was appointed to look into the police firing that happened in Paramakudi in 2011, 7 Dalits were killed, and this commission held that the police had to fire in self-defense, and it completely exonerated the culprits. And it's not only that, you know, with killing of Dalit that it takes place. We have to look at what happens. At a protest in Kalinganagar, Orissa, on 2nd January 2006, the state police opened fire on a protest by local tribals against the takeover and seizure of the land by a Tata steel plant. 16 people died on the spot, 4 more died in the hospital. And now it's also very interesting, because when the bodies were sent back, apparently 4 of them received their bodies without the hands being chopped off. So in 2006, the state appointed the Justice A.S. Naidu Commission, but the commission was closed in the next year. And so Justice R.K. Patra Commission was appointed the following year in 2008. But then this Justice Patra got appointed as Lokpal, so this commission was closed. And then the Justice P.K. Mohanty Commission was appointed. So what happens is that these commissions start playing a musical chairs. And the truth about what actually happened in Kalinganagar, what's the role of Tata, why the police have to go and fire people on behalf of Tata, all this never came into question. On the other hand, when a commission looks as if it's going to do some justice, a commission like the Justice Amirda's commission, which was probing into the political violence against the Dalits in Bihar, to all the carnages, probing into the links between the Ranveer Sena and the political elite, it was disbanded. It was one of the first acts of the Nitish Kumar government to disband this commission so that the truth doesn't come out. And now that I talk in the last three instances about what happened in Manjolai in Tamil Nadu, what happened in Paramakudi, or what happened in Kalinganagar, I sometimes wonder that even before multinationals must have come with the idea of outsourcing in order to exploit cheap labor conditions and the easy availability of raw material in the third world, the idea of outsourcing must have existed in another sense, because it's not always possible for the caste Hindus to go and do the killing of the Dalit themselves. I think they invented this concept of outsourcing this to the police. So when the corporate cannot clear the land, the operation is outsourced to the police and the paramilitary. Sometimes state terror is also used like an extension of the arm of the ruling classes and the ruling castes, to go on their own killing spree. And also the fact is, even if my whole talk is going to only concentrate a lot on the judiciary, I think it's very important that we should not forget that just as the police have routinely behaved in a completely casteist sense, even the Indian Army, which I think is this hallowed organization, has been behind some of the worst caste massacres that have taken place in this country. And there was recently Operation Black Rain, a sting operation that did done by Cobra Post, which showed the links between how between the Ranveer Sena and the Indian Army. For example, AK-47, and how did the Ranveer Sena get these weapons was apparently because when the military auctioned its reject weapons or reject firearms, and apparently people to the level of the Prime Minister were involved, the weapons went straight into the hands of the Ranveer Sena, and the Ranveer Sena was using things like LMGs and SLRs, just to wage their war against the Dalit people. And I now also quote from this book called Community Warrior State, Peasant and Caste Armies in Bihar. In creating armed squads, the Sena has been helped immensely by the Bhumihars working in the Indian Army and various paramilitary organizations such as the CRPF, the BSF and so on. Evidence of this involvement of army men and the BSF personnel came in the aftermath of the Sendani massacre, when Gaya police arrested two serving army men and a BSF constable. Their recruitment, that is the Ranveer Sena's recruitment, has been sourced from men of their caste serving in the Indian Army. And according to a report from PUDR, the military prowess of Ranveer Sena, unlike other private armies run by amateur, was the result of the extensive training given to the Sena members by retired army personnel. And now suddenly Indian democracy, you can begin to see it in a lot of new light. So if you look at the good old slogan, Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan, I think that now you understand that this is nexus between the Indian Army and the feudal landlord, So, yeah, the Indian states and its complicity is something that we have to take in a much more serious way. And on the one hand, you have Dalits who are denied justice, the killers of Dalits every day being freely allowed to, acquitted for all their crimes. But what happens to Dalits within the system? On the one hand, Dalits are denied justice in the courts, they're not even able to testify the truth because they are threatened, because their lives are at the mercy of the oppressor, because the state fails in its duty to protect them. They're lampooned when they turn hostile witnesses, they're deliberately killed when they turn up to testify the truth. The little slips of tongue in the deposition is held against them. Nowhere is the state's failure to protect Dalits called into question. At no point is the state held responsible or the state punished for its callousness. Neither does the state step up its act, even as a face-saving measure. On the other hand, witness what the state is actually doing to the Dalit people. Those who kill Dalits will be released from jail, and instead Dalits will be thrown in jail on the easiest pretext. Can anyone deny the mad haste to criminalize Dalits? A Human Rights Watch report, Broken People, published more than a decade ago, spoke of how Dalit assertion was always followed by the criminalization of Dalit activists. It's common knowledge that the oppressive acts like UAPA or the National Security Act have been used to incarcerate Dalits on a mass scale, where even parliamentary Dalit parties like the Vidudhalai Chiruthaigal have been militant. Hundreds of their cadres are left to languish in jail, even today, under NSA and the Gundas Act. The National Crime Records Bureau survey, Prison Statistics India 2013, showed that 53% of Indian prisoners belong to Dalit, Adivasi and Muslim communities, clearly revealing the bias of the police in the judicial system. And because we are discussing India under Modi, let us also take a little detour from this talk to look at the situation of Dalits in the Gujarat model. Around 32.9% of all convicts and 23.4% of all under trials in Gujarat prisons are Dalits, a community that forms just about 6.7% of the state's overall population. Put simply, the data suggests that the proportion of Dalits among Gujarat's convicts is nearly 5 times higher than the share in the state's population, with its under trial members up to 3.5 times higher. If this is the Gujarat model is what awaits the rest of India, we are surely racing towards depressing times. And now is, I think, the time when we have to stop and ask, what then are the factors that enable the state machinery, in this case the police and the judiciary, to get away with such an atrocious handling of the massacres of Dalits? From a Marxist perspective, it would do well to recall that the state is an instrument of the instrument for the exploitation of the oppressed class. In understanding how the state apparatus was intertwined with the caste structure, Dr. Ambedkar drove home the point most tellingly. And I quote him, "From the capital of India to the village, the whole administration is rigged by the Hindus. The Hindus are the life of the omnipotent Almighty, pervading all over the administration in all its branches, having its authority in all its nooks and corners. There is no loophole for anyone opposed to the old order to escape. If the old order has continued to exist, it's because of the unfailing support it has received from the Hindu officials of the state. The Hindu officials are not merely administrators administering the affairs of merit. They are administrators with an eye to their parties. Their principle, it's not justice, equal justice for all. Their motto is justice consistent with established order. This is inevitable, for they carry over into administration the attitude towards different classes in the society under the established order. As critical as he was of the officials of the state system and aware that they would manipulate the administration according to their own casteist whims and fancies, he was also unwavering in his observation that inequality formed the backbone of Hinduism, and he used the system of its criminal jurisprudence as one of the examples where this inequality is enshrined." They quote Dr. Ambedkar. "The most striking feature of Manu's penal code, which stands out in all its nakedness, is the inequality of punishment for the same offence. Inequality designed not merely to punish the offender, but to protect also the dignity and to maintain the baseness of the parties coming to a court of law to seek justice. In other words, to maintain the social inequality on which this whole scheme is founded. The principle of graded inequality has been carried into the economic field." It's important for us to pause here and try and understand how Dr. Ambedkar talks about the Hindu social order, in other words caste, and how it permeates the economic field. Instead of making a full frontal attack on capitalism and the unequal method in which it crystallizes wealth in the hands of a tiny, tiny minority, Dr. Ambedkar actually calls upon the Marxist dictum, from each according to his ability to each according to his need, which when realized by a society will be the most advanced state of communism. As Lenin observed, when a society adopts this rule, where labor is so productive that people voluntarily work according to their ability, and when there will be no necessity to distribute the products, which the people can take freely according to their needs, this will be the stage where the state will have withered away completely. This, in Lenin's words, marked the move from formal equality to actual equality. The antithesis of this objective of equality is the core of the Hindu social order, where caste reigns supreme. To quote Dr. Ambedkar again, "From each according to his ability to each according to his need is not the principle of the Hindu social order. The principle of the Hindu social order is from each according to his need to each according to his nobility." In Dr. Ambedkar's perspective, the casteist mindset would wreak havoc upon the very idea of moving towards such a goal. He illustrates this inhuman nature of caste and simultaneously shows us how deep its roots run. Supposing an officer was distributing dole to a famine-struck people, he would be bound to give a greater dole to a person of higher birth than he would to a person of low birth. Supposing an officer was levying taxation, he would be bound to assess a person of his higher birth at a lower rate than he would a person of low birth. The Hindu social order does not recognize equal need, equal work, or equal ability as the basis of reward for labor. Its motto in this regard to the distribution of the good things of life, those who reckoned at the highest must get the most and best, and those who are classed as the lowest must accept the least and the worst. Nothing more seems to be necessary to prove that the Hindu social order is based on the principle of graded inequality. It pervades all departments of social life. Every side of social life is protected against the danger of equality. The struggle for a socialist society, the struggle towards communism cannot happen under the Hindu social order is shattered until the all-pervading caste mentality is dismantled beyond recognition. This is not the fashionable reading that exists among the neoliberal elite of today who believe in the salvation of the free market. They are blind to the horror of caste. They do not realize that such an intrinsically unequal system like caste will combine with a vicious, merciless capitalism to consolidate its own monstrosity. In absolute contrast to these capitalist handmaidens, we have the cautionary voice of Dr. Ambedkar writing on India and the prerequisite of communism, pointing out how the poisonous, well-entrenched division of caste can thwart and pose an insurmountable resistance to the most revolutionary paradigm from even taking root. And it's not only about communism, but even within the four corners of bourgeois democracy, Dr. Ambedkar was very perceptive to the dangers posed by a criminal justice system that was totally infused by caste and inequality. He took great pains to point out how justice could be and would be thwarted. I quote his prophetic words. The official is anti-untouchable and pro-Hindu. Whenever he has any authority or discretion, it's always exercised to the prejudice of the untouchable. The police and the magistrate, by reason of their motives, interest and their breeding, do not sympathize with the living forces operating among the untouchables. They are not charged with the wants, the pains, the craving and the desire which actuate the untouchables. Consequently, they are openly hostile and inimical to their aspirations, do not help them to advance, disfavor their case, and snap at everything that smacks of pride and self-respect. On the other hand, they share the feelings of the Hindus, sympathize with them in an attempt to maintain their power, authority, prestige and their dignity over the untouchables. In any conflict between the two, they act as agents of the Hindus in suppressing this revolt of the untouchables and participate quite openly and without shame in the nefarious attempt of all Hindus to do everything possible by all means, fair or foul, to teach the untouchables a lesson and hold them down in their own place. In these words of Dr. Ambedkar, you can already foresee how the demands of Dalits for justice will play out in India. Has not teaching the untouchables a lesson been one of the main aim of each of these massacres? In Kilvenmani, teach the untouchable a lesson for carrying the red flag of communism, for demanding higher wages, for fighting untouchability. In Villupuram, teach the Dalits a lesson for daring to try to rise to the level of the caste Hindus, teach the Dalits a lesson because one of their women objected to being molested. In Tsundur, teach the Dalits a lesson for taking claim to equality, for being educated, for being self-sufficient. In Bathani, Tola, in Meyanpur, teach the Dalits a lesson for being sympathizers of the far left. In Laxmanpur, Bathe and Shankar Biga, teach the Dalits a lesson because they were waging a struggle for land, a struggle for wages, a struggle for dignity. In Manjolai, teach the Dalits a lesson for the temerity to march to the collectorate, for demanding living wages in the tea plantations. In Mela Valavu, teach the Dalits a lesson for standing in panchayat elections. In Paramakudi, teach the Dalits a lesson because they wanted to celebrate the anniversary of one of the revolutionary leaders, Immanuel Sekaran. In Faridabad, teach the Dalits a lesson for their political aspiration. Elsewhere in India, teach the Dalits a lesson because otherwise your caste Hindu itch for superiority will not subside. And as Dr. Ambedkar pointed out, in any conflict between the Hindus and the Dalits, the police and the magistrate acts as agents of Hindus to suppress the revolt of the Dalits, participating openly and without shame in teaching a lesson. There cannot be a clearer condemnation of the casteist nature of the Indian state mechanism than this. Let us then understand that injustice, so deeply rooted within the system, is the rent that parliamentary democracy and its extensive state apparatus paid to caste. In order to satisfy the purpose of its creation, the state, the byproduct of the antagonism of the oppressed and the oppressing classes, has to ensure that this injustice becomes the order of the day. Sometimes, to keep this structure in place, there is use of brute force. That's why, when the caste Hindus cannot kill, the police do the job for them. But always, they cannot be pressed into action. It's reserved for special occasions, special people. Kashmir, the Red Corridor, the Northeast, the militant Dalits. For the rest of the masses and the rest of the days, this is ensured through a wide variety of devices. For instance, and this is something that I want to point out, though it does not have a lot of relevance to my topic today, the language of the legal is a language that is opaque, a language that's out of access, a language that's meant to confuse, a language that's meant to scurry you to the dictionary. Is this not in itself deliberate? Again, why is it that in the high courts in this country, the language of jurisprudence is not the language of the local people, but English? I think that this usage of language is not an accident. One can even say that this judgment, which denies justice to the Dalit people, is the second act of massacre. The upholding of the crime, the legitimizing of the crime by reducing it into a set of incidents and procedures and material objects, the trivializing of the crime by reducing the dead individuals to a long list of unnamed dead bodies, the escape provided to the caste Hindu criminals from facing the wrath of the people by allowing them to abscond and sometimes by arresting them to place them under total police protection, providing a safety net for the caste Hindu who is raped and murdered and massacred and pillaged. It's a language that's used to cause delay, even the stimulus response of feeling angry. It's a language that's meant to bury your humanity, your sense of outrage within a complex web of technicality. It's a language that mines deep into people's words to use the inconsistency in Dalits, or women, or Muslim, or Adivasi depositions and testimonies to send them home with no justice, to wear out everyone who seeks justice, because these courts know that any man, any woman requires fists of gold and the feet of steel to traverse the corridors of law. Those who believe that this towering sense of authority is merely followed in the realm of the argument and the text have to visit a court, any court in India on a random day. Why are our esteemed judges blind to their own narcissism? I have a lot of questions for them. Instead of enjoying the pomp and parade, should you not feel uncomfortable as you are piloted by a tabedar in a fancy dress? Do you not feel ridiculous as this tabedar hisses, demanding that everyone stop their speech so that a silence descends upon the courtroom when you enter? Do you enjoy the way the corridors have to clear like the parting of the seas when you make your way to the chambers for lunch? Do you particularly relish that long stare into nowhere? Because given its track record, any justice in India cannot meet anyone's eye. Do you not shift uncomfortably in your chair when you're constantly called, Your Honor, My Lord, My Lord, My Lord? I have never seen royalty in my life, but I guess the supplication that is required from the public must be slightly less over the top than such petty tyranny. Call this a colonial hangover, call this a caste hangover, call this the decorum of the court hangover, call it whatever it pleases you, but for an outsider it becomes difficult to distinguish between the self-aggrandizement in the conduct of the court and the self-importance that is reflected in your judgments. Part of the problem is also the judiciary's narcissism. Admiring itself from head to foot in between every line of its exalted observations, it has, in the instance of caste massacres, tried to follow the ugly precedent that it has set for itself, to try and find any argument, however heartless, however lame, however illogical, however stupid, however brazenly casteist, in order to never convict those who carry out the most dastardly crimes. If anyone in the system paid attention, they would see the judiciary for its rotting teeth and its festering wounds and the deadly stink of casteism. However, beneath the shroud of pressed white shirts and long black robes, there is no one paying attention to its grievous illness. So convinced and hysterical is the judiciary in its belief that it's beyond reproach that it takes course to slapping contempt proceedings on anyone who dares to make the slightest murmur of disapproval. One of the funny benefits of bourgeois democracy is that you can call the Prime Minister a communal fanatic, you can call the President a rubber stamp, you can call out the HRD Minister for her absolute lack of educational qualification, but the freedom of speech stops there. You cannot say that the caste, you cannot even cast a shadow of doubt upon the judiciary in this country. You cannot say that the caste of the judges has a definitive role to play in why those accused of committing the massacre of Dalits are allowed to go scot-free year after year. You cannot say that the caste of the judges plays a role in deciding the composition of the judiciary itself. You cannot say that the caste of the judges decisively dictates the reasoning behind the staunch opposition to the reservation policy. You cannot say that the judges are communal when they hang a man to satisfy the collective conscience of this country. You cannot say that a judge of the Supreme Court has no business quoting a racist, casteist, misogynist text like the Manusmriti in order to justify the bloodthirst of the death penalty. These and many things of a similar character can never be uttered. Like a self-worshipping, long-serving dictator, the slightest sign of defiance is enough to set this monster on a revenge spree, and the first threat made to the dissenter is the threat of being thrown in jail. The word of our judges, like the word of Jehovah, like the word of an Old Testament God, is beyond question. Anyone who questions these almighties might as well prepare for the future by packing the toothbrush for the stay in Tihar. what happens when someone decides to question or criticize the functioning of the judiciary? Let me point out to the case in Tsundur, where I have access to the judgment of the Andhra Pradesh High Court. This was the case where the feudal caste of Reddys perpetrated a massacre and killed 8 Dalits. And this case was being heard by a division bench that included Justice Narasimha Reddy. And I quote from the judgment. An affidavit by one Shri Moses, said to be associated with an organization and who did not figure as a witness in the case, was filed stating that he lost faith in the bench, having regard to the way the proceedings were going on. And this is where it's easy to be misled. Days after I read this judgment of the court, days after I heard about the proverbial, almost wrathful Moses enter the picture, I had the opportunity to read the publication called Tsundur, An Atrocity and Its Aftermath, that was bought out by the Human Rights Federation in Hyderabad. That's when I learned that Mr. Moses, who was being described by the court with the word said to be associated with an organization who did not figure as a witness in the case, was actually not some wayfarer who put his nose into the affairs of this bench. He was the son of one of the murdered victims and the nephew of another murdered victim, and he was therefore a party who had a lot to lose if justice was not rendered. Once again, the wheel of words, once again, the play of hide and seek, which when played by the court means hide the fact and seek to distort. Let us now come back to how the court dealt with this matter. Let me quote the word of Justice Reddy and his counterpart. To be guided in this behalf, we requested the learned Attorney General of India to render assistance. On his behalf, the additional Solicitor General, Sir Shri Wilson, appeared and advanced arguments according to him, raising an objection as to hearing of a matter by a bench that to halfway through amounts to gross impropriety, and of all the persons, the public prosecutors cannot resort to that. He further submitted that it's a case fit for issuing contempt notice to the person that have raised objection for hearing of the matter. He cited fairly good number of precedents. After hearing the learned special public prosecutors, we passed a detailed order on 21 March 2014. The registry was directed to issue contempt notice. Even before any notice was issued, the person who filed the affidavit tendered apology and has withdrawn his affidavit. Therefore, we dropped further proceedings against him. Let me repeat the crucial words for emphasis, Solicitor General of India. Please note that no Solicitor General of India appears on behalf of the state when Dalits are killed. No Solicitor General of India has fought tooth and nail to see that those who kill Dalits are locked up for life. But when the casteist functioning of the court is called into question, the Solicitor General of India makes an appearance. This power of contempt that has been vested in the courts, when used in a manner that has just been outlined, reminds me not only of the most ruthless dictators, but also remind me of some of the worst caste atrocities. Can we forget that when two Dalits tom-tommed their anger and spoke back, they were fed human excrement in Thinni Yemen in 2002? Sometimes in rural India, the price for speaking truth to power is shit being force-fed to you. Sometimes in a more sophisticated place, such as in the courtroom, it's a contempt notice. Either way, the message to Dalits is crystal clear. Swallow your self-respect, swallow this shit. Even as we discuss Tsundur, I want to highlight another facet. We have looked so far at the judges, but who turns up in court to defend these murderers? According to the judgment, note this down, the argument on behalf of the appellants are advanced by Shri T. Bali Reddy, learned senior counsel, Shri O. Kailashnath Reddy, Shri Pradyumna Kumar Reddy, Srimati Vasundara Reddy, Srimati Gayati Reddy. Almost as if the need to defend the caste fanatic was a religiously enshrined duty of the caste system. Reddys defending Reddys. In Kilvenmani, a Tambayya Naidu defending Gopalakrishna Naidu. And this happened in those times when the Chief Justice of the Madras High Court was himself a Naidu, and the court was sometimes called the Tamil Naidu High Court. Just as scientists speak of carbon-carbon bonding that gives strength to diamond, someone has to discover the DNA of this caste-caste bonding that makes this entire depraved system an impenetrable fortress. Having said this, I think that the task of exposing the judiciary's casteism cannot be complete without pointing an accusatory finger at each of us. If the courts had been pulled up for their horrific miscarriage of justice in the Kilvenmani massacre, would they have found the brazen courage to repeat that feat in massacre after massacre? Where is our sense of collective outrage? Why does our civil society not bring the functioning of these courts to a standstill? Where are our politicians, each of them vying for the share of Ambedkar's legacy? Each party, whether it's the Congress, the Communists, or the BJP, portraying themselves as the savior of Dalits, trying to take upon these ivory towers. Where is the media? When Kilvenmani happened, the media was eager to blame the Dalits for their own deaths. But we live in a society where the media is in charge not only of the manufacture of consent, as Chomsky would say, but also the manufacture of outrage. One has to begin wondering why this free press has often stayed silent when Dalits have been denied justice. Why has the idea of campaign journalism been forgotten in these cases? Is this perhaps directly linked to the absence of Dalits and Adivasis in the media? Is it merely a byproduct of the fear of what the courts will say? Is this perhaps a class factor? Because it's not only that the Dalits died, but also that they were the most poor, the completely landless, the extremely oppressed. Because those who were killed were not people like us, middle class, urban. The anger, and of course it's a very rightful anger that journalists and filmmakers expressed over the murder of Jessica Lal, was absent for the women of Bathani, Tola and Laxmanpur, Bathe. The anger over the debauched handling of Arashi Talwar by the police and the judiciary, the books and the reams of newspaper columns that have been written about this one child has not happened for the Dalit children of Bathani, Tola, the Dalit children routinely massacred in this country. Sometimes there are crimes that are worse than silence. One of that is sophisticated victim blaming. Here is an example. After that landmark, benchmark, trademark, ugmark, caste mark judgment, where a Reddy judge acquitted all the Reddy murderers in the Tsundur massacre using the flimsy pretext of delay and lack of complete corroboration between the witness, the fortnightly magazine Frontline, that often pretends to be radical, doled out this advice. Many feel that Dalit organizations should start looking inward to understand why prosecutions were failing quite frequently, even though dedicated human rights lawyers have argued these cases. They must pay more attention to pursuing cases vigilantly by filing proper first information reports and gathering unimpeachable evidence and witnesses' account, which are crucial to ensuring justice. Brahmin media here is no different from Brahminical judiciary. Look at the kind of victim blaming that they are easily taking, you know, just blaming the Dalits, saying, oh, you didn't do proper work, you know. We cannot expect this Brahmin media to wake up to reality and start accusing the courts of their casteism. What we have here is the system of the Manusmriti. You can give the laws of Manu and the justice is the same. You can create colonial laws under the British. You can start a jury system and the justice is the laws of Manu. We can create the modern courts. We can have a Dr. Ambedkar who burnt the Manusmriti. We can have an Indian constitution and yet our courts behave in the same way. They dole out same Manusmriti justice. Let us not forget that on the one hand, Justice Dave of the Supreme Court of India can quote Manusmriti to send Yakub Memon to the gallows. One day on the dusty tomb of the Indian judiciary, we might well inscribe the epitaph, descended from Manu, here lies the legal arm of the caste system. This deep-rooted connection between Hinduism and the Indian state is something that cannot be ignored. This is the Hinduism of the Indian state which makes us circumscribe the category of Dalit within Hinduism. In the same Tsundur judgment, what's the mischief of the judges who take time to point out? Almost every witness examined by the prosecution, hailing from the village, pleaded that he is a Hindu Mala or Madiga. The defense cross-examined the witness at length to prove that they had been converted into Christianity. Does it matter? Did the fact that the Dalits were Christian or Hindu matter in the slightest regard when it came to the massacre? The sooner we wage a successful struggle to ensure that Dalit Christians and Dalit Muslims are given the same rights as Dalits, we cannot prevent Kandamals and Erayurs from happening. Such a poisonous mindset not only percolates from the judiciary into the wider society, but also fans the already existing hatred. We already have caste Hindu politicians like S. Ramadas of the Patali Makkal Katchi who have become emboldened enough to seek the repeal of the Prevention of Atrocities Against SCST Act and who is building a coalition of similar caste groups in Tamil Nadu to give momentum to this demand. The mere existence of such an act, which is a paper tiger in its most majestic moments given the caste nature of this judiciary, the mere existence becomes an affront to caste supremacy. Since I mentioned Tamil Nadu, I should also immediately touch upon something which is very important to me as a Tamil, which is the reservation policy. This might be beyond the ambit of my lecture, but the caste-infested mentality of the courts are betrayed not only in the cold-blooded manner in which they exonerate the caste Hindu murderers, but also the frenzy they adopt to prevent the benefits of reservation policy from reaching the Dalits, Adivasis and the other backward castes. When the Dalit revolutionary Ayyankari opened a school for Pulayar children in Venganur in Kerala, because they were being denied admission, the caste Hindus burnt his school down. The urge to prevent Dalits and other oppressed communities from achieving the benefits of education has never been lost in all these years. The hate story of the judiciary, reservation policy, is a long epic of betrayal. Several judgments from the High Court and the Supreme Court will attest to it. Even 2 days ago, Justice Deepak Mishra of the Supreme Court of Caste Discrimination spoke about the need to scrape reservation and higher education, citing national interest. Again, we observe how national interest is not national interest, but basically Brahmanical caste Hindu ruling class interest. Let us not be careless and complacent and think that the education which is being denied to the Dalits and the oppressed is some kind of bourgeois education, an education that's not going to radically empower the people, an education that does not prepare one for revolution. Let us not sit on the high pedestal of academia and reduce education into one medical seat, one cutoff mark, and some stupid notion of merit. Education is intrinsically linked to revolution. It's not for nothing that the Brahminical Hindu social order tries to prevent Dalits people from gaining access to education. I once again want to quote Dr. Ambedkar extensively here. Writing on the preservation of the social order, he notes, "The outbreak of a revolution is conditioned by three factors. The existence of a sense of wrong, capacity to know that one is suffering from a wrong, and availability of arms. The second consideration is that there are two ways of dealing with a rebellion. One is to prevent a rebellion from occurring, and the other is to suppress it after it has broken out. The third consideration is whether the prevention of rebellion would be feasible, or whether the suppression of rebellion would only be the method, would depend on the rules which govern the three prerequisites of rebellion. When the social order denies opportunity to rise, denies right to education, and denies right to use arms, it is in a position to prevent rebellion against the social order. Where on the other hand, a social opportunity allows opportunity to rise, allows right to education, and permits the use of arms, it cannot prevent rebellion by those who suffered the wrongs. The Hindu social order has adopted the first method. It has fixed the social status of the lower orders for all generations to come. Their economic status is fixed. There will be no disparity between the two. There is no possibility for grievance growing up. It has denied education to the lower orders. The result is that no one is conscious that his low condition is a ground for grievance. If there is any consciousness, it is that no one is responsible for the low condition. It's the result of fate. Assuming there is a grievance, assuming there is a consciousness of grievance, there cannot be a rebellion by the lower orders against the Hindu social order, because the Hindu social order denies the masses the right to use arms. This is the reason why the merit argument is used, the national interest argument is used, the youth for equality argument is used. This threat of a revolution is the reason why the state uses every power to thwart the reservation policy. This threat of revolution is the reason why education, in the rare cases where it's provided to the Dalits and other oppressed people, is often tied up to heavy bank loans, so that even an awakened individual is a victim of a debt trap. If you look at Dr. Ambedkar's analysis carefully, you will also understand that it's also why any political group in India that advocates the rights of the oppressed people to use arms in their own defense and in the defense of their own rights is banned from functioning in this country. This is why we have Operation Green Hunt. Sorry for having strayed so far away and already ending up in the red corridor. Let's come back to these courts, these citadels of caste power. There may be a few who believe that it's the chair that decides, the chair that hears both sides, the chair that passes judgments, and hence stay away from making any comments about the nature of work the chair does or the kind of discrimination that it perpetuates. There might be a few people who really believe that among these chairs there is no space for individual bias because, well, chairs after all are chairs. Unfortunately, these chairs, we have learned from bitter experience, also wear the sacred thread and other markers of caste. These chairs flaunt their caste surnames. These chairs alone select other chairs. You see, it's a matter of taste. And for the selection procedure, they go shopping once in a while. Sometimes it can even invite the boundless wrath of the chairs, who might slap you in the most chairly fashion possible and abuse you with the chairiest curses. It does not take a lot of effort to unmask the chairs to show their true caste colors. In fact, this project has not been undertaken by any foreign-funded NGO or the so-called great internal security threat that's seeking the overthrow of the Indian state, but by the National Commission of Scheduled Caste itself. But before I go on record, let's hear from Justice Ratnavel Pandian in 93 in the Supreme Court's Advocate on Record versus the Union of India. I won't quote him entirely, but I will tell you. I venture to express the right of entry into superior judicial office is not the exclusive prerogative of any particular coterie or privileged class of people. To say it differently, it's neither inheritable nor a matter of patronage. And then he starts quoting the statistics, and these are 93 statistics, so I'm going to skip them. It's in my text, but not in my speech. 18 years later, when the National Commission for SCST went to find the ground reality, it was observed that there were only 24 judges belonging to SCST against a total of 850 judges in all high courts. Out of the 21 high courts, 14 high courts do not have a single judge from the SCST. As of 2011, when the Commission published its report, there was no SCST judge in the Supreme Court with its strength of 31 judges. Making a strong and committed stand against this exclusion, the Commission made it clear. A firm policy of reservation in judiciary is the only remedy. The government needs to change its policy of running with the hare and hunting with the hounds. After all, judiciary should reflect and meet the aspiration of the people. It cannot live in isolation and put itself outside the ambit of constitutional provisions through judicial pronouncements. One of the highlights of this report was the manner in which it called out the judiciary for its discriminatory treatment of judges belonging to SC and ST communities. It took issue with the way Justice C.S. Karnan of the Madras High Court was being treated. Sharing the story from Chhattisgarh, where 17 district judges, all belonging to the SCST community, were removed. When they had 10 to 5 years of service left, the Commission pointed out that it was merely because they were maturing for elevation as High Court judges and the system was trying to prevent it. The Commission report also observed that the Bombay High Court and the Delhi High Court have not followed the policy of reservation in the staff employment for the last 61 years. The Madras and Rajasthan High Court do not follow any policy of reservation for SCST in the case of gazetted and promotion-based posts. Finally, the Commission reserved its parting comments to these upholders of merit, these courts that live merit and breathe merit and speak merit, and exposed the casteism inherent in the appointments. About 67% of the appointments are made out of advocates practicing in the court. An analysis of the appointment made in the last 6 decades would show that the appointments revolve around a few families, only even among the privileged sections of the society who do not constitute even 1% of the country's population. To perpetuate the hereditary system, which is akin to the system of archaka and village officer, career of the person belonging to the family and acquaintance of judges who are already holding posts in High Court and Supreme Court is nurtured very carefully from the beginning. In North India, advocates belonging to these privileged sections are appointed to the Superior Court in their early 40s, keeping an ultimate eye on the Chief Justiceship or the Justiceship of the Supreme Court. To build the necessary atmosphere, praises are paid to them in the judgment while they work as a lawyer before their appointment to the court. Judges from the weaker section, on the other hand, are invariably appointed in their 50s and thus kept out of the consideration of the principle of seniority. So it would be naive to imagine that merely affirmative action will radically alter the character of the Indian judiciary overnight, but it will no doubt change its composition. This leaves us with one last question. Can a Dalit judge do justice under the existing state structure? Can even a Dalit police officer work unimpeded and bring a culprit to book? In the Gokul Raj murder case, where a young Dalit man was beheaded by caste Hindus for daring to love a girl from the OBC, the investigating officer was a brilliant Dalit officer, Vishnupriya. She was all of 27 years of age. She came under pressure from higher officials to implicate innocent people in the case and let go of the criminal mastermind and perpetrated Yuvraj. Unable to bear the pressure, she had to take her own life. There is no doubt that Dalit judges will also come under similar pressures and similar threats. We can revisit our oft-visited atrocity spot, Tsundur, to see what happens when a Dalit is asked to sit in judgment over a Dalit massacre. I quote from the book published by the Human Rights Federation. Dr. Prabhakar Rao was appointed as a special court judge. The defense counsels, I mean all these reddies whose name I just read out, also threatened in open court that if Rao continues to be the judge, they would stop defending their client and the judge was free to conduct the proceedings in their absence. This is the nature of the judiciary, where only caste Hindus can deliver a caste justice on the basis of other caste Hindus. Where do we begin to show our anger? When do we bring these judgments and burn them in a public bonfire to show that this kind of caste justice will not be carried out in our names, carried out under this constitution? How do we avenge the dead? Will it not be the last wishes of each of these victims, of each of these massacres, who died in a state of unforgiving terror, that the cold-blooded, caste-fanatic police and judges who betrayed them, who made it possible for the guilty to escape being sent to jail, to spend time along with the murderers? The failure of the judiciary is only one half of the story. When justice delivery mechanisms fail, when courts stand exposed as an extension of caste panchayats and caste institutions, people are forced to take justice into their own hands. They have to pursue their own methods to get a fair deal. Let us not forget that no matter how convinced the Madras High Court was about his innocence and how impressed they were with the vast tracts of land that he owned and the ambassador that he drove, that in spite of the heavy political clout that he enjoyed with the Congress Party, Gopalakrishna Naidu, the butcher of Kilvenmani, was killed in retaliation to the massacre. What survives in the form of an oral legend in these parts is how his body was hacked into 44 pieces, wrapped up in palm fronds and distributed among those who had lost their families. What happened to Brahmeshwar Singh, the chief of the Ranveer Sena, the butcher of Bihar? He was killed as well. There are limits to which this justice system, this police state, this caste society can shield these murderers from the wrath of the people. It took 12 years to avenge Gopalakrishna Naidu, but on the 14th day of December 1980, people delivered the justice that the courts had failed to deliver. In the case of Brahmeshwar Singh, he could not survive a year after he was let out of jail. This could not have happened if only there was a properly functioning and impartial judiciary. The systematic denial of justice to the Dalit people is a genocidal hate. Yes, I use the word knowing that it will not hold in any court of law, but nevertheless, there is no smaller word to describe the macabre degree of hate that you reserve against Dalits. Of course, I give you the contempt that you worked so hard to earn. I spit at you because you have repeatedly, systematically, purposefully failed to deliver justice. I curse you because you have allowed the most fanatic caste Hindu killers to walk away without any punishment. I wish you dead because you do not treat the life of a Dalit with any value or respect. I wish nothing grows on your tomb because the remnants of a corrupt, caste-ridden institution like the Indian judiciary cannot give birth to anything but poison of the worst kind. I dare you, I dare all courts in this land, because you can't send writers and dissenters and cartoonists to jail, but the men who massacre will be sheltered and honored and feted. You kill the constitution on a hourly basis. You trample upon the rights that were hard won by people's struggles. You forgive corporates for their loot, for their non-payment of taxes to the tune of crores of rupees, and yet you turn a blind eye when Dalit people are criminalized for no fault of theirs, when young and innocent Dalit and Adivasi and Muslim men fill up your horrible prisons. You lack any grand vision of justice. Your talk of being the epitome of judicial activism is nothing, but I've read enough already to know that it's only empty advertising. You sit on judgments about the reservation policy, you call for it to be scrapped, you even say that it is a privilege and it is against national interest when your own ranks, like the India media houses, are Dalit-free zones. Just like the Nazis used the word Judenfrei to designate the Jew-free zones for areas that were cleansed of the Jews, you want to make higher education and the judiciary into this country into a Dalit-free zone. Let us not forget that 14 of the 21 high courts do not have a single Dalit judge. Let us never forget that in the long history of the Indian Supreme Court, only four Dalit judges have been appointed. You have become synonymous with injustice. Your pronouncements merely reflect your patriarchal, misogynist, casteist, feudal, Hindu fundamentalist, corporate apologist, state terrorist mindsets. Your judgments over the course of decades have made caste maniacs know that they can kill an entire village of Dalits without having to spend a day in jail. To the girl from Suryanelli, raped by 42 men over a 40-day period, the question that you unfailingly, unflinchingly ask, why did she not escape when she had the opportunity? To the young Dalit man who survived the Tsundur massacre, you wonder why he got himself admitted in the hospital without informing the police. To the Dalit man from Bathani, Tola, who has witnessed the murdered corpses of his family, you will ask why he took time to make a complaint. This casteism, this complete heartlessness is your true face. While you are at it, you will also elucidate your grand truths. Upper caste men would not have raped a Dalit woman. A landowning Mirastar who also owns a car would not have walked to a village to set it on fire. A murderous caste mob would not have allowed male survivors A mob of landlords set fire to a locked hut with 44 people, but they did not have the intention to kill. Please keep your injustice to yourself. I too believe in the revolution like Comrade Anuradha Ghandi did. Unlike her, I do not know where the revolution will begin in India. But wherever it begins, the revolution will replace your courts no later than by the first sundown. I want to remind the courts in this country of the famous slogan, no justice, no peace. Let's salute. Thank you.
Thank you, Meena, for that absolutely power-driven and emotion-filled talk. And I must share with all of you the friends and comrades who knew Anuradha would have found a little resemblance in the way Meena delivered her talk. I was just remembering how Anu used to be remembered as a speaker who delivered her speeches at machine gun pace. So here was Meena. We had to tell her to slow down a bit, but whatever notes were made, I hope will do justice in the translation. Jyoti?
Because Jyoti came late, I am just attempting a translation. ऐसे तूफानी भाषण को जो हरिकन की स्पीड से था अनुवाद करना बहुत कठिन है क्योंकि मैं ग्रास्प नहीं कर पाई तो मैं संक्षिप्त में और मेरी बुरी हिंदी में थोड़ा सा पेश कर रही हूँ. मीना कंदासामी ने शुरू किया था ये कहते हुए कि हरियाणा में अब जो फरीदाबाद में दलित बच्चों की हत्या हुई ये कोई अनोखी घटना नहीं है क्योंकि दलित बच्चों को मारना ये दलित कत्ल जो होते आए हैं हमारे देश में इसमें बच्चे भी रहते हैं तो इसलिए हमारे देश में बहुत बार ऐसा हुआ है. मीना ने जो उपन्यास लिखा है द जिप्सी गॉडेस ये किल्वेनमनी के हत्या पर है जो 1968 में एक गांव में तंजावुर में जहां जमींदार और गरीब किसान खेत मजदूर के बीच में संघर्ष चल रहा था वो लोग कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी के नेतृत्व में यूनियन बना रहे थे तो इस संघर्ष को खत्म करने के लिए ये हत्या हुई थी और इसके ऊपर उन्होंने ये उपन्यास लिखा है. इसी प्रकार की घटनाएं फिर चुंदूर में करम चेडू में बथानी टोला में सभी जगह में हुआ है और हर बार इस केस में ऐसे केसों में न्याय व्यवस्था ने जिन्होंने ये हत्या की है जो जमींदार समाज के लोगों ने हत्या की है उनको निर्दोष छोड़ दिया है. तो इसलिए मीना कंदासामी ने अपने वक्तव्य का शीर्षक रखा है कि दलितों को किसी ने भी नहीं मारा क्योंकि अगर ये लोग निर्दोष है तो किसने मारा है तो ऑब्वियसली किसी ने भी नहीं मारा दलितों को. तो न्याय व्यवस्था हमेशा एक मुखौटा पहन के कोशिश करती है दिखाने के लिए कि वो न्याय दे रहे हैं वो प्रगतिशील है लेकिन हर बार ये जो अक्यूज्ड है इसमें वो निर्दोष छूट जाते हैं. और फिर मीना अंबेडकर को कोट करते हुए बताती है कि डॉक्टर बाबा साहब अंबेडकर ने भी ये बताया था कि इस व्यवस्था से पुलिस से न्याय व्यवस्था से कभी न्याय का अपेक्षा नहीं रखा जाता है क्योंकि ये सवर्ण हिंदू होते हैं और इसलिए ये न्याय व्यवस्था ये पुलिस सिस्टम दलितों को कभी न्याय नहीं दे सकता है। वो कहती है कि बथानी टोला में जो 20 लोगों को मारे थे उसमें से 19 महिला और बच्चे थे, लेकिन इस बात को लेकर के जुडिशरी ने प्रश्न पूछा था तो पुरुष कहाँ थे, तो पुरुष क्यों छिपे थे, तो क्या पुरुष इसमें कोई संघर्ष में थे, तो वो गलत प्रश्न पूछते हैं। वो पूछते हैं छोटी छोटी बातों के बारे में, लेकिन ये कभी जो मूल प्रश्न है कि यह हत्या क्यों हुई, इस हत्या के लिए कौन दोषी था, ये जो मूलभूत प्रश्न है ये कभी पूछते नहीं। जैसे सुंदूर के जब जजमेंट हुआ था तब उन्होंने कहा था कि 3 महीने के लिए जो अक्यूज को यहाँ पे छोड़ा जा रहा है निर्दोष, कोई जश्न नहीं मनाएंगे, कोई सेलिब्रेशन नहीं करेंगे। तो मीना पूछते हैं कि 3 महीने बाद क्या वो जश्न मना सकते, मतलब ये एक विडंबना क्या नहीं है कि 3 महीने बाद रेड्डी लोग सेलिब्रेट करेंगे और दलित लोग अपने प्लैकार्ड निकाल के फिर से संघर्ष करते रहेंगे। और ये सिर्फ दलितों के साथ नहीं होता, जहाँ जहाँ आदिवासियों का प्रश्न होता है, जहाँ उनको बेघर किया जाता, जहाँ विस्थापन होता है, वहाँ भी ये प्रश्न उठाया जाता है। और फिर आता है ये प्रश्न कि ऐसे घटनाओं के लिए क्या पैसे के मुआवजा से कोई मतलब होता है। पटना के जजमेंट में वो कैलकुलेट करने बैठे थे कि हर एक जो मर गया है इसका उम्र क्या है, इनका क्या पोजीशन था, कितना मुआवजा दिया जाएगा, लेकिन लाइफ लाइफ होता है और इस जीवन का, किसी भी जीवन का, दलित हो, गरीब हो, बच्चा हो, बूढ़ा हो, क्या इनको पैसे दे करके हम भरपाई कर सकते। फिर विभिन्न जुडिशियल कमीशन बिठाया जाता है, इस सारे कमीशन में वो सवर्ण लोग होते हैं और कभी ये दलित लोग इसमें नहीं रहते हैं। कमीशन के बाद कमीशन रिप्लेस होते रहता है, जैसे कि वो म्यूजिकल चेयर्स खेल रहे हैं, और ये कमीशन्स का भी कोई फायदा नहीं होता। और फिर वो कहती है कि कभी कभी खुद जो ज़मींदार है वो कत्ल नहीं करते, ये आउटसोर्स करते, जैसे हम काम देते हैं, सिलाई का काम किसी को दे देते हैं, इस ढंग से वो आर्मी को, पुलिस को ये आउटसोर्स करते हैं। और यहाँ भी हम देखते कि जो आर्मी पुलिस इसमें वही लोग रहते हैं, जैसे रणवीर सेना को जो हथियार AK-47 वगैरह मिला था, ये मिलिट्री का ही जो नीलाम हुआ था उसी से मिला था। जो भूमिहर जात के लोग जो फौज में थे, इन्होंने ये मदद किए थे। और इसलिए मीना कंदासामी कहती है भारत का जो नारा जय जवान जय किसान, इसका मतलब है कि मिलिट्री और ज़मींदार, ये किसान और ये लोग, इनमें जो मिलीभगत है कि दलित गरीब शोषित लोगों की हत्या करने के लिए। और वो पूछती है कि किस ढंग से राज्य व्यवस्था दलितों को मदद करती है, सारे जज, सारे न्याय व्यवस्था के लोग गैर दलित होते हैं, तो कौन से तरीके से वो मदद करते। बल्कि इसके विपरीत हम देखते हैं कि दलितों को क्रिमिनलाइज किया जाता है, दलितों को गुनहगार माना जाता है, जब वो संघर्ष करते उनके ऊपर UAPA जैसे काला कानून लगाया जाता है। गुजरात के जेलों में अधिकतर दलित ही है। तो आखिर में जैसे डॉक्टर अंबेडकर ने कहा था, आज भी मनुवादी न्याय व्यवस्था ही होता है। जैसे मनुस्मृति में है कि अलग अलग लोगों को अपना जो अपनी जो सजा है वो उनके जात के अनुसार मिलनी चाहिए। आज ऑफिशियली तो ये नहीं है, लेकिन प्रैक्टिकल में हम वही देखते हैं कि जो गरीब लोग हैं उनको ज़्यादा सज़ा मिलती है, उनको ज़मानत नहीं मिलता, और जो उच्च वर्णीय लोग हैं, अमीर लोग हैं, इनको बहुत आसानी से छूट मिल जाता है, ज़मानत या सज़ा नहीं मिलती। और फिर से डॉक्टर अंबेडकर को कहते हुए वो कहती कि जैसे मार्क्स ने कहा था कि हर एक को अपने क्षमता के अनुसार काम करा के अपने जो ज़रूरतें हैं वो पूरे करने के लिए लोगों को देना चाहिए, लेकिन हमारे देश में अंबेडकर ने कहा ऐसा नहीं है, लोगों को अपने क्षमता के अनुसार काम करा के उनसे लिया जाता है, लेकिन दिया जाता है लोगों को अपने सामाजिक जो स्थान है, जो जात है, उसको देखते हुए। तो इस ढंग से न्याय व्यवस्था का पूरा एक क्रिटिक जो अंबेडकर ने किया है ये भी मीना ने रखा है। इसके बाद मैं रिक्वेस्ट करती कि ज्योति पुनवानी कुछ बोले।
बहुत अच्छा बहुत तेज बोल रही थी मैंने जो लिख पाई मैं लिख पाई मीना उन्होंने कहा कि जो भी दलितों के नरसंहार हुए हैं वो उनको सबक सिखाने के लिए हुए हैं या तो जब वो अपने लिए जो मिनिमम वेज पगार मांग रहे थे या कभी कभी चुनाव के लिए खड़े हो रहे थे तो उनको ये बताने के लिए कि आपकी औकात क्या है इसके लिए उनको मारा गया है और पुलिस ने भी हिंदुओं के दलाल का काम किया है इन नरसंहारों में और हमारे सो कॉल्ड तथाकथित डेमोक्रेसी में लोकशाही में जाति के प्रति अन्याय हमारे इसमें जुड़ा हुआ है जिसे हम लोकशाही कहते हैं वो सही में उच्च जाति के तथाकथित उच्च जाति के लोगों के लिए बना हुआ है। फिर उन्होंने पूरे न्याय व्यवस्था का एनालिसिस किया है कि एक तो न्याय कोर्ट की भाषा क्यों इतनी कठिन होती है क्यों अभी ब्रिटिश के जाने के बाद तो बहुत साल हो गए हैं लेकिन अभी तक भाषा अंग्रेजी ही क्यों है एक्चुअली मराठी भी है यहाँ पर तो लेकिन ज़्यादातर हाई कोर्ट्स में अंग्रेजी ही क्यों है इसके पीछे कुछ तो कारण होगा और वो कहती है कि इसका ये कारण है कि आम लोगों को समझ वो समझ ना पाए क्या हो रहा है कोर्ट में उनको अलग रखने के लिए और इस भाषा के द्वारा पूरी जो इंसानियत जाग सकती है जब ऐसे कांड होते हैं उसको मारने के लिए ये इंग्लिश भाषा और इतनी कठिन भाषा इस्तेमाल की जाती है और दूसरी बात कोर्ट के बारे में है कि वो अपने आप को बहुत ही ऊंचा समझते हैं एक तो जो उनके पोशाक है मतलब वो जो रोब्स वगैरह वो अभी तक पहनते हैं जबकि दूसरे देशों में ये नहीं है और ये वकीलों का जो सफ़ेद शर्ट काला ट्राउज़र वगैरह उसके पीछे उतनी दिखने में तो बहुत अच्छा लगता है लेकिन उसके पीछे भी जो जात की भावना है वो सब छुप जाती है और जो अन्याय हमारे कोर्ट्स में होता है वो उनके पीछे छुप जाता है और दूसरी एक अहम बात उसने कही कि हम प्रधानमंत्री और राष्ट्रपति को गालियां दे सकते हैं लेकिन हम किसी जज के बारे में कुछ नहीं कह सकते हैं हम मोदी को सांप्रदायिक कह सकते हैं लेकिन किसी जज को ये नहीं कह सकते कि वो जात उसकी जात के वजह से उसने ये जजमेंट दी है तो जो कोर्ट जजेस हैं वो क्रिटिसिज्म या जो उन पर जो भी आलोचना के ऊपर उन्होंने अपने आप को कर लिया है तो जबकि ये साफ है कि कोर्ट में जात का बहुत बड़ी भूमिका है कुछ कुछ जजेस मनुस्मृति को भी कोट करते हैं जो सब जानते हैं कि मनुस्मृति में दलितों के बारे में औरतों के बारे में क्या क्या लिखा हुआ है वो पूरी तरह से उच्च वर्णीय एक ग्रंथ है तो उसको भी जज कोट कर सकते हैं और जिस जज ने मनुस्मृति को कोट किया था उसी ने याकूब मेमन को फांसी दी थी तो ये लिंक ये जो हम देख सकते हैं कि जज की जो मेंटालिटी है जो उनकी मानसिकता है वो उनके जजमेंट में साफ नज़र आती है लेकिन हम ये कह नहीं सकते क्योंकि हम पर कंटेम्प्ट आ जाएगा हम लोग पर भी आने वाला है तो लेकिन मैं सिर्फ ट्रांसलेट कर रही और उन्होंने कहा है कि तमिलनाडु में जैसे जब दलितों का नरसंहार होता है तो जो उच्च वर्णीय जो आरोपी हैं उनको उच्च वर्णीय वकील उनके लिए खड़े होते हैं और इतना तक कि जज भी उच्च वर्णीय है तो तमिलनाडु का कोर्ट तमिलनाडु कोर्ट कहा गया था क्योंकि सारे नायडू और रेड्डी वहाँ थे वकील और जज दोनों और वो पूछती है कि हम क्यों इसके ऊपर आवाज़ नहीं उठाते हैं अगर कभी हमने आवाज़ उठाई होती तो शायद पहले नर्स किल्वेनमानी नरसंहार के आरोपियों को छोड़ा गया, लेकिन शायद बाद में दूसरे नरसंहारों के आरोपियों को नहीं छोड़ा जाता। लेकिन मीडिया क्यों इस पे खामोश है? जब जैसिका लाल के ऊपर इतनी हम मीडिया कैंपेन कर सकती है, पूरी मुहिम चला सकती है, तो दलितों के बच्चों के लिए क्यों नहीं चला सकती है? ये वजह यह है कि जो मरते हैं वो गरीब हैं, जो दलित हैं, और हमारे जैसे लोग नहीं हैं जो मीडिया में काम करते हैं। और मीडिया में दलित और आदिवासी बहुत ही कम हैं, इस वजह से मीडिया इनके बारे में इतना आक्रोश नहीं दिखाती है जैसे जैसिका लाल और आरुषि तलवार के बारे में दिखाती है। मतलब वो भी दिखाना चाहिए, लेकिन इनको भी, इनके लिए भी उनको दिखाना चाहिए। उन्होंने ये भी कहा है कि रिजर्वेशन के खिलाफ जो भी कोर्ट में जजमेंट आई है उसमें भी उनके उच्च जातीय मानसिकता नजर आती है। जब अभी अभी शायद आज या कल आया था कि राष्ट्रीय हित में हमें उच्च शिक्षा में रिजर्वेशन नहीं होना चाहिए, तो ये राष्ट्रीय हित मतलब किसका हित? इसका मतलब है ये सिर्फ उच्च जाति का हित, मिश्रा जो जज है उसके बारे में वो सोच रहे हैं। और हमारे पूरे सिस्टम में दलितों को शिक्षा से दूर रखा गया है, क्योंकि वो नहीं चाहते हैं कि दलित शिक्षित होकर अपने हक मांगे और शायद क्रांति भी करें, तो इस वजह से उनको दूर रखा गया है। और इस वजह से रिजर्वेशन को इतना मुश्किल बना गया है, और हर वक्त उसके खिलाफ, रिजर्वेशन के खिलाफ या तो जजमेंट आती है या कोई कैंपेन होता है। इनका कहना है कि ये समाधान ये है कि जुडिशरी कोर्ट में जजों के अपॉइंटमेंट में रिजर्वेशन होना चाहिए। जब एक तमिलनाडु के जज ने अपनी आवाज़ उठाई कि सिर्फ उच्च वर्णीय जज अपॉइंट हो रहे हैं, तो उनके ऊपर उनको काफ़ी सज़ा मिली। लेकिन इसके सिर्फ सुप्रीम कोर्ट में सिर्फ 4 जज दलित हैं, तो इससे पता चलता है कि दलितों को कोर्ट से बाहर रखा जा रहा है और रिजर्वेशन के अलावा और कोई चारा नहीं है। लेकिन ये भी पूछती है कि क्या इस व्यवस्था में क्या दलित जज भी न्याय दे पाएंगे? जैसे इस व्यवस्था में क्या दलित पुलिस न्याय दे पाते हैं? हेलो, अगर आपको ट्रांसलेशन नहीं चाहिए आप निकल जाइए ना, तो बहुत मुश्किल है वैसे भी ट्रांसलेट करना। तो इस जुडिशरी में रिजर्वेशन हो भी तो क्या दलित जज न्याय दे पाएगा? क्या दलित पुलिस ऑफिसर न्याय अपना फर्ज निभा सकता है बगैर प्रेशर के? अभी तमिलनाडु में एक दलित पुलिस ऑफिसर ने आत्महत्या की क्योंकि उन पर बहुत ही प्रेशर था। तो इस व्यवस्था में शायद मुमकिन ही नहीं है कि कोई दलित को आज़ादी से काम कर कोई दलित आज़ादी से काम कर सके। और इस वजह से, क्योंकि कोर्ट और जजों ने अपना काम नहीं किया है, अपना फ़र्ज नहीं निभाया है, तो मजबूर होकर लोगों को न्याय के लिए लड़ना पड़ा है। और अपने किस्म का न्याय उन्होंने दिया है। जब उन्होंने देखा है कि कोर्ट में उनको कुछ नहीं, उनकी सुनवाई नहीं होती है, और कोर्ट हमेशा ये कोशिश करती है कि अगर जात के ऊपर नरसंहार हो तो कोई और कारण उसको निकाले, या किसी भी कारणवश उन आरोपियों को सजा न दे, तो और कोई चारा नहीं रहा है। लोगों ने खुद उन नरसंहार के लीडरों को मारा है, जैसे किल्वेनमानी, हाँ, वहाँ पे जो भी उस सबसे बड़ा जो आरोपी था उसको लोगों ने काटा। नर्स, ये बिहार में रणवीर सेना का जो नेता था ब्रह्मेश्वर सिंह, उसको भी मारा गया। तो चाहे बहुत समय लगे या चाहे एक साल में, लेकिन लोग अपना बदला लेते ही हैं क्योंकि उनको न्याय नहीं मिलता है। और वो आखिर में कहती है कि ये कोर्ट जिसने कभी दलितों को न्याय नहीं दिया है, जो बड़े बड़े कंपनियों के माफ़ करती है जो भी उनकी गुनाह होते हैं, लेकिन जो बेगुनाह दलित आदिवासी और मुसलमानों को जेल में पड़े रहने देती है, उनको क्रिमिनल बना देती है, तो ऐसे ऐसे कोर्ट को वो उसके ऊपर वो थूकती है, उसको वो शाप देती है, उसको कहती है कि मैं आप तुमसे नफरत करती हूँ. Not me. आखिर वो कहती है कि जैसे अनुराधा गांधी ने कहा था कि वो क्रांति में विश्वास करती है, तो वो भी क्रांति में विश्वास करती है और वो सोचती है कि वो ही एक समाधान है इस पूरे उच्च वर्णीय और दलितों के खिलाफ व्यवस्था का.
Whoever's gone out because the translation session was going on, now we'll have the question answer session. We have half an hour, so the mic can go around, but please put up your hands.
Can we have a volunteer to take the mic around?
Ajay.
Hi, Meena. My name is Gurbir Singh. I've got a question for you. The question is this, that however rotten, however narrow the reservation system is, there has been a reservation system in place which has, in various layers, absorbed hundreds and thousands and thousands of Dalits into the system as government servants, in education, even very high levels of the Indian administrative IAS services. And you also had a chief justice in the form of K.G. Balakrishnan, probably known to be the most corrupt judge probably in the higher judiciary. Now, in whatever way the system has created this reservation system, there have been, it's a sort of answer, and today we defend it politically. So the question to you is, though we stand up and defend it, because the reverse is a sort of Hinduist casteist system which tries to do away with it, as we see with the Patel agitation and so on. But at the same time, in your fairly deep study which you have presented, how much has this whole system of reservation solve problems, or in, do you think that has actually worsened the situation?
I think, you know, for 4 years of my life, I spent time teaching in a university, and whenever I went and told my students, we should annihilate caste, which is the most important thing that we should do as Indians, my students would tell me, yes, madam, we should remove the reservation system. So somehow, and for this I don't really have the words, you know, I have maybe even the words to shout at the judiciary. For this I don't even have the words because I'm so angry. How do you even equate annihilation of caste with the removal of the reservation system? You know what I mean? Like, It's the smallest pittance that is given out. It's the most minimum concession that the state and the caste Hindus are making to Dalit people. So it's the most small thing, and if that makes you so upset, and actually the fact is I'm talking to you, I came here to talk about caste atrocities. We know that at least on date 1,000 people have been killed in various massacres. No justice has been done to them. They've been killed in the most brutal manner. You have whole families being massacred. You have 44 people locked in a hut. And when I talk to you about something so deeply disturbing, so emotional, something for which justice is failed, and the only speck of dust in your eye is the fact that somebody is enjoying reservation, I don't know how inhuman that is to even, you know, front this as the most important question that is worrying you, because I think there are far more important things. And so, yeah, I have my own issues with the... Having said that, I have my own issues with the fact that can you do any change within Indian system? No, I don't think so. As I told you, I showed how the judiciary is completely casteist, how the police are completely casteist, how they're all complicit in killing Dalits, in corporate loot, all of this. So do you think this Indian system will change the world, change India itself? I don't think so. But does it mean that this Indian system, as rotten as it might be, should it be exclusive or should it be inclusive? I think it should be inclusive. I think we should have reservations. There can be no other question. I mean, like, if you are questioning reservations, you're outing yourself as somebody on the lines of Gopalakrishna Naidu or Brahmeshwar Singh, you know. That's my opinion. No, I don't
know. You still not answered my question, ma'am. My question is, as a political scientist, put the emotion aside for a minute and just say, what sort of impact do you think it has had? Over 60 years, 70 years, what sort of impact has it had? Has it been positive, negative? I'm asking a neutral question.
Yeah. You can ask me. I can also ask you a question and ask you to put aside the fact that you're a political whatever and ask you how your night was last night, you know. I can ask you a question. I'm not asking you. But I can tell you what the reservation policy is. I can tell you that Meena Kandasamy will not be sitting here if it was not for the reservation policy. The fact that my father went to school was because of the reservation policy. My grandmother's on my father's side did not know how to read and write. So yeah, if I got to where I am, it is because of the reservation policy. It is because of Periyar, it's because of Ambedkar, because of their struggle. But not only that I'm here in front of you, but also the fact that a person like my father could wear a shirt, the fact that he could go to college, that he could educate himself. It's all because of the reservation policy. Otherwise, I will be running behind some buffalo or working on some farm. So yeah, it has changed. It does change. The reservation is a way for individual emancipation, but the question we are asking and the question I'm worried about, should we stop at individual emancipation or should we also go towards a more revolutionary society? I don't think these are two different questions. Any other questions?
I think the picture you painted of the Indian judiciary as a casteist, probably very little debate about that. But I want to know, has any attempt been made to challenge these judgments in the higher courts to try and make little small loopholes? It's been done in the case of workers, it's been done in the case of certain other human rights, very limited victories perhaps on the legal field. Has any such attempt been made in these cases which you've cited? Because going by what you've quoted, there are obviously many things that could perhaps be challenged in the higher courts.
If you look very carefully at all these various convictions, what happens is that trial court always implicates a few people. And the higher court decides to reverse the judgment. And when I was reading about bourgeois democracy and what is justice, there is this interesting concept that Bukharin says. I don't agree with a lot of other things that he says, but this is very interesting. He says, what happens when you have this series of courts, you know, this hierarchy of courts in a country? He says that, is it good or is it bad for the working class people? Is it good or bad for the class struggle? And he talks about how once you establish a system of hierarchy of courts, the oppressed class will go to any court. They keep on going from court to court till they get the judgment that they want. And I think it's very true of, you know, even this caste massacre, because every time you have a lower court which sentences 4 people, 5 people to like imprisonment or death, and then the high court completely acquits everybody. So I don't know if going to a higher court actually has got justice in the case of this, because sometimes by the time the case reaches the high court, in most cases it's a gap of 12 years, 15 years. The incident is not even so fresh in people's memory. This court is, you know, conducted not locally, but conducted in a, like, you know, with so many layers in between. And it becomes very easy for them to pull out one or two sentences and, you know, just deny justice.
Is very stuck that democracy depends on the institution of the state. That what you are saying, that institution has been completely failed. Institution has been completely failed. That like law and order machinery, law and order institution, judiciary, there is a complete failure, and the health of the institution reflects that health of the democracy. So how, what is your suggestion? What should be the panacea for the ills of our this sort of thing? Because ultimately the people's sovereignty is not taken care of, which is really a hallmark of a democracy. I would like to...
No, I think if you want to look for solution, you can look for solution the way Comrade Anuradha was looking for solution, because you can look for solution in organizing the people, you know, you can look for solution in trying to, you know, look at this section, you know, these problems of democracy, try to understand what it is. But I think that especially what we have in India is a very particular system, because elsewhere you have only a very a democracy that's a democracy of the elite or the capitalist class, you know, so capitalist bourgeois democracy. What you have here is also a democracy that is very intertwined with caste. So yeah, I think that to challenge it would also mean to challenge the caste system at its root.
My name is Mayappan. I'm from Government Law College, Madurai. As much as I would like to agree with you regarding the official language of the court, it should be the people's language and the court language, the Lord and all that. But then, my question is this. You criticize a system, but do you think an alternate system will be without the vices that this existing system has? Do you think you can, you know, if you cannot correct the existing system as it is right now, if you cannot correct it from within, you can keep or, you know, put another system in place and keep it perfect, if at all?
Nowhere in my talk have I said cannot correct the existing system. In fact, if you, I'm not sure that that is the solution, but can you attempt to correct it? I think all of us here, even as we dream of, you know, faraway day of revolution, I think we are all doing what we can to correct the system as it exists, like whether it's asking for reservation, asking for greater inclusivity, asking for justice. Even the demand for justice is a demand that shows that we want the system to be accountable to us. So I don't understand why you think that I have given up on the system. I think that there is no ideal struggle, and that we have to wage struggle for equality at every venue. So why not challenge the existing system as well? I think we should. Please speak a little louder for me. And
yeah, I wanted to ask, has there been anybody speaking out about the trend that the judicial system has set in this manner and is following from so many years? And what has been the impact of people speaking up about this, if any? Has there been anybody who has been addressing this issue that has arisen with focus on the judicial system itself in a public space, and what has been the impact of it?
Were you there for my lecture? No, because I quoted Dr. Ambedkar extensively, and if you heard those, you will understand that he was constantly criticizing the magistracy, the way the judicial system is operating, how the law is going to work against the Dalit people, how it's going to not take them seriously. So yes, I think whether it's Ambedkar or Periyar or anybody, I think people have constantly, consciously called into criticism the functioning of the judiciary system. So what do you mean? Do you mean, has it been on your school syllabus or something?
People like
People like us. Who is people like us? Ambedkar is not common enough. I think there are lots of human rights groups, civil liberties groups, various other things which are happening, no, on the issues you're talking about. So they are all actually questioning the judiciary, fighting for changes in the judiciary. There are lawyers groups, human rights groups. Okay, so we'll move to some other questions.
Have you, this is Shrikant Moda. Have you sent any articles on this to mainline media? Mainstream media, and what has been the response?
No, actually, I haven't written on this particular topic, but I have written a book on what happened in Kilvenmani and the how the justice delivery system failed. It's a novel, but I don't like to use the lecture as a plug for my own writing, so it makes me embarrassed. But I also did write something in, which is even more upsetting for me. Is not only is the judiciary so casteist, and this is something I never spoke today, you also have one of the most misogynist judiciaries in the world. So when women are raped, the way, the kind of questions that the judiciary asks, like for instance, I talk about this girl from Suryanalli, you know, who was raped by so many. One of the other questions that was asked when the High Court is that, apparently, one day she left home without telling her parents for a picnic. So they said she's a woman of bad character and therefore she did things like this. And there's some testimony from teachers that she didn't listen to them or didn't do the homework. And that was extrapolated to mean that she willingly did what she was subjected to. So I think if you look at the judiciary and its treatment of especially rape cases, and sometimes there was a rape of a child and, you know, the judiciary is doubting if it was, you know, the mother inflicting this kind of a sexual wound on the child. I mean, consistently you have women being degraded day in and day out by the judiciary. You have judiciary which say that a divorced woman cannot claim alimony. You have judiciary which says we should castrate men who are child sexual abusers. So I think it's, you know, my talk today has been very narrow, but I think the judiciary is... You know, if you talk about misogyny, we can talk for 4 hours.
My question was, have you written on any of these subjects?
Sir, I have answered your question. I told you I wrote one book. I wrote some articles about this misogyny.
Sir, that is a book you wrote. That is a different thing. But in any of the mainline media, have you sent any of your articles actually?
Shrikanji, everybody writes in different spaces. She's a creative writer. She's not a journalist. She's a poet, novelist. You know, so that's how she writes. It's a good suggestion. Maybe she can think about it. Any other questions?
In India, Dalit people facing injustice in one or other way, that we cannot deny it. But you are, in your speech, I have heard that revolution is a must. So to become a revolution in the earlier, before in the 21st century or 22nd century, how we should talk and what we should do.
Understand your question. What do you
revolution
mean?
To become revolution, what we should do or what we should talk.
I don't know. I think that everybody gets you know, what is the revolution and what is the, you know, if revolution is the birth of a radically different society, and how do we all enter the revolution? So I personally think there is this quotation from a black American writer called Tony K. Bambara, who says, the duty of the radical artist is to make the revolution irresistible. So in that sense, I think that as a writer, the prospect of revolution is something that you have to constantly put forward before the people. So on the other hand, if you look at the life of Comrade Anuradha, for instance, you know that she lived the life of the revolution. She left the middle class comfort. She left, you know, a lot of things, simply sacrificed it at the drop of a hat to go and join, you know, the revolutionary forces in this country. And so everybody can contribute to the extent that they want. And I think sometimes, you know, it's one thing to be a revolutionary, but sometimes even to be part of the process, one has to become much more politically conscious. And it can start, you can start by reading Dr. Ambedkar. I think I read him when I was 17 or 18, and it had a lasting impact. So you can read the Communist Manifesto, but I think only when we read, we know what we have to do, or only when we talk to like-minded people, we know how we can get involved. So it really, I don't know if there is any quick fix formula, because if you're a student, what is revolution? How do you take part in something revolutionary? If you are a worker, how do you take part in something revolutionary? If you are a woman and a feminist, how do you take part in the revolution? I think that each of us can bring something to the revolution. So it's a very individual. What can you give the revolution is the question that you should ask instead of saying. So I think it's, there is no direct answer that I can say.
I have a question. My name is Arun Ferreira. I've been following you on social media. So the discourse, the way you have what you call analyzed the state, the caste nature of the state is, who are the judges, what is the caste, who are the lawyers, what is the caste, that type of thing. It's okay, there's no problem, that is analysis. But what sometimes it happens is, in a movement, that same type of logic also applies. That then, you know, you start questioning what is the caste of the person who's talking about the caste atrocity. So how do you see that debate? I know you have written about this on social media and all, but I would like you to reiterate, how do you see this type of debate in a movement?
No, I think Arun, there is blatant casteism, like in the Tsundur judgment, you know, the reddies and the reddies and the reddies, and I think we have to call it out, because there is nothing else, you know, and we cannot say that because we do not subscribe to identity politics does not mean not mentioning this thing, you know. The fact that we fight for a communist society where anybody can be a revolutionary, you know, if they forego their privilege, does not mean that we will not call out racism when we see it, and we just think that it's structural, or it's, if some white person who is rich is behaving badly towards a person who is poor, who is black, we will not only say it's an economic question, but also call out the racism that is inherent in this dynamic. So I think that the fact that oppression is multiple doesn't mean that we can erase the fact that these judges' caste played a role, because I don't think my speech was only about the caste. It was also about, you know, the fact that they were using all these loopholes, the fact that the judiciary was like this, the police was like this. I was not going even into the caste composition of the police. And also, I think caste does play a role. We cannot say that the Ranvir Sena, the Indian Army, of the nexus of the, you know, the Bumihars, is not unconnected. So there is obviously a caste link, so let's not forget that. But I think when it comes to revolutionary movement, I think there is an interesting concept, I think, which the Maoist used, which is the concept of declassing. Is that, have you declassed, you know, like, it's sometimes applied in a very crude manner. I was once married to a Maoist, so I know what the fuck it is, but still, there is a crude, misogynist manner of applying declassing to, you know, beat a woman, to suppress her right, it's possible. But at the same time, declassing as a concept means also losing your privileges in order to identify and become one of the working class. It means losing, has somebody, you know, lost all the privileges of caste? Has somebody, you know, is there any way in which they behave like a casteist? And I think these are litmus tests. And I think everybody will be judged based on how they react during a turbulent or on a moment of crisis. So in a moment of crisis, whose side are you on? Are you opportunistically with the side of your own caste? Or are you on the side of the oppressed? So I think the question is always a question of, you know, I think a crisis in any revolutionary context, in any difficult context, a crisis will reveal the true colors. So, you see, and this is something again and again, which we know, isn't it? Like there was an encounter and two people were killed like a month or two ago, and there was a lot of torture of this girl. And the man's name was Vidya Sagar Reddy, I think, and I saw the Reddy's surname, and I felt, well, his name is Reddy, so, but also it does mean that there is a very, there is a section of, you know, caste Hindu men who do, you know, join the revolutionary forces in this country. So I don't think that, you know, just talking about the caste background to shut up some people, as it is being done, as it was done in the case of Arundhati Roy's book, just saying that, you know, she belongs to the elite section of society, therefore she has no right to comment. I think in that sense, I think a true revolutionary will never alienate anybody from coming and supporting his cause, you know, or her cause. So I don't think that if you're using the kind of gatekeeping to keep away genuine forces of solidarity, I think it's a shame. It means that your revolution is not a revolution. Your change is a kind of careerism or promotion. So I don't think that if anybody raises this kind of question at people who are genuine, then I would view that with a lot of skepticism. But on the other hand, I do think that when we see caste, and we see caste do its discrimination blatantly, when we see race, when misogyny, we should call out this. We cannot always look for the structural or economic paradigm, you know, because there are things beyond that as well. Oppressions are, you know, I think intersectional in their own way.
In a very brief way, Ashwini, you were talking about the oppression of caste, and you were talking about Ambedkar's solidarity towards the democratic movement. I just briefly wanted to ask you, I had read that Ambedkar and some of his junctions was also critically of the Marxist and class analysis. Isn't it so important also in the movement to combine the caste work and the caste oppression with the class oppression? Because we need, from a theoretical framework, don't we need that? Ambedkar sometimes was wanting in the theoretical aspect of class, because he was very critical of the caste, but then he was not bringing in the social aspect of class, which is what I have learned. Could you just speak briefly about this?
See, today I specifically picked out quotes of Ambedkar which show that he is revolutionary, and I think that he is revolutionary, you know. So the things that he says, what are the preconditions for revolution, the fear of Dr. Ambedkar, who says that, you know, even the basic idea of Marxism is exactly opposite to the idea of what the caste system enshrines. This is all the fear of an intelligent man who knows that you just cannot have, you know, he has analyzed all of this in his work on, you know, like communism, saying why, what are the problems that communism would face. But also, as much as, you know, it's very childish and naive to say Ambedkar was anti-revolution or anti-communism, because we have to take into account the period in which he lived, and we have to look at the Stalinist or the communist parties of the time. Because if you look at them carefully, the Madras Labour Union, for instance, was formed in 1918. And this one of the incidents that sparked the formation of this Madras Labour Union was that in one of the mills, there was a caste Hindu worker who wanted a break. He wanted a break to be able to go to the toilet, but he was not given a break. So he shat himself, and he had to clean up. Now the fact is, he cleaned it, and then all the employees were upset that a caste Hindu had to do the job of a Dalit. And this was the spark of the first, you know, strike or whatever. So now we understand that what is a very class issue here, which is the employer denying a right to an employee, had at its heart a very caste sentiment, the caste sentiment that only a Dalit should clean shit. So if this is the Indian Marxist movement, so let us call out for what it is, you know. I think a true revolutionary, a true communist will say, yes, we made many, many mistakes, but we have to change. But are the Marxists willing to make this kind of admission? Are they willing to make the admission that, you know, for instance, how the communists in Bombay, for instance, were constantly against Dr. Ambedkar? What was the betrayal of S.A. Dange? Why, you know, why they never allowed this man's... when Ambedkar saw communists, he possibly was seeing the likes of the opportunist lackeys like S.A. Dange. So, and the people who said, that the Rig Veda is the example of the communist society. So when he saw Brahmins like this, and when he saw that only Brahmins were doing the theorizing, I'm sure not only Ambedkar, but all of us will be scared of communism, you know. If there is a communism that only Brahmins can handle and interpret, then the Communist Manifesto becomes the Bhagavad Gita or the Veda, you know. But the fact is that is exactly how early communism in India was. The only interlocutors were Brahmins, so naturally he was skeptical of them. But beyond that, we have to understand, and a lot of people, I think, for instance, Teltumde would dismiss Ambedkar and say he has not read much of the left literature, but I don't think that is the case at all, because I today quoted this thing about agility and need. And also, if you understand the most famous Ambedkarite slogan, educate, agitate, organize, it was the slogan used by Antonio Gramsci in his paper in Italy. So, you know, Gramsci is a great leftist, a great left theoretician, was using the same slogan as his paper was called The New Order or The New World. This was the same slogan, educate because the masses have to be awakened, agitate because the masses have to, you know, strike or gather, organize because only the combined power of the masses can, you know, cause change. So Ambedkar has his, even his slogans are very based in communism. So this false dichotomy, just using Ambedkar as, you know, this capitalist or market-friendly face, I don't have any sympathy for that. But also, let us understand that communism greatly, greatly, greatly betrayed the Dalits. So we have to understand, like the working class in Puliyanthoppu, when the Dalit work, there was the Binni Mill strike going on, and this is in Madras in the 1920s or 1910s. Dalits refused to participate. For Dalits, they in the general strike, in the strike in the mills, because they wanted food. So Dalits were used to break the strike. But how would the trade union, how should the trade union have handled this? They should have handled it by pooling in their resources, by trying to see that the Dalit workers were supported, that they had some kind of support or solidarity. But instead of this, the trade union response was to go and burn Dalit homes in Puliyanthoppu. Now you point fingers and tell the Dalit people are not revolutionary, they are not communists. Well, I'm sorry, but unless we put out this black charter of what so-called the Stalinist communism did in India, what how they are, you know, alienating Dalit people, unless we acknowledge it, and I think any true communist will acknowledge that, yes, we messed up badly, but we want to clean the slate. I think until we do it, there can be no communist revolution. So, because no revolution is going to happen in India without the Dalits taking part and leading the struggle, actually. So I think that maybe if they really are committed to revolution, they will look back and acknowledge their mistakes. I think that's how it should start.
I think on this note, we should stop the question answer session.
Thank you, Meena, for that very lively and interesting question answer session, and for all those who raised the questions. Now I'll call upon Shoma to conclude today's meeting.
Friends, there's not really much that I would like to add after this fantastic presentation by Meena, which has covered so many aspects of the caste question from both a Marxist and an Ambedkarite point of view. But just taking up from what Meena said, that a true communist or a true revolutionary, how would that person approach caste? And linking it with Anuradha Ghandi, I would like to say that she was one such person, and there are many people like her in the movement to which she belonged. When Anuradha was in that phase of her life that she was teaching as a professor in Nagpur University, many people suggested to her to do her PhD. And she took up the idea for a brief while and started studying on the caste question. But later on she realized that this is not the vocation, that she wants to do her PhD and rise up as a professor. And she gave up this study. But much of the research that she did was actually written in the form of booklets, and it is also published in the book of Anuradha Gandhi's writings, Scripting the Change. So in this, she pointed out, she traced the history of the growth of caste in India, and then she pointed out how it appears and it works both in the economic system, in the ways of production, as well as in the culture, language, religion, and other things. And she was very self-critical, like many others in the party to which she belonged, that the left movement, the communist movement in India has done a huge mistake and not taken up the caste question seriously. And in fact, trade unions have just blinked an eye. There are Dalit autobiographies where Dalit people have written that workers drink water from different water pots. Ek matke mein Dalito ke liye pani rehta hai aur dusre mazdoor jo savarna hai wo dusre matke se pani peete hain. To is prakar ka bhedbhav trade union movement mein chalte aaya hai, paramparik communist party ne kiya hai aur Anuradha Gandhi ne is galti ko aur unke jaise jo saathi unke movement mein the, is sare ne in galtiyon ko swikara. Aur ant mein Anuradha ne analysis karne ke baad कुछ पॉइंट्स भी बनाया जो मुझे मालूम है कि मीना कंदासामी भी इसको प्रेज करती हैं कि शी मेड अ सॉर्ट ऑफ चार्टर ऑफ व्हाट काइंड ऑफ टास्क्स देयर इज फॉर द कम्युनिस्ट मूवमेंट टू टेक अप व्हाट आर द पॉइंट्स ऑन व्हिच वन हैज टू फोकस टू इरेडिकेट कास्ट एंड फॉर द एनिहिलेशन ऑफ द कास्ट सिस्टम. हम ये भी जानते हैं कि आंध्र प्रदेश में एक विशेष रूप से अलग संगठन बनाया गया. Means even in Andhra Pradesh, the movement studied this, and just as you have separate women's movements, the movement, an organization for annihilation of caste, was a separate organization started in Andhra Pradesh by people, some of whom are Maoist sympathizers. They had formed this kind of separate organization. And Anuradha also wrote in her writings that the struggle for annihilation of caste will continue after new democratic revolution. Being a Maoist, she saw revolution in two stages, the stage of new democracy and then socialist revolution. So even after new democratic revolution, how this struggle should continue, what are the things you have to be careful against, aur kaise sangharsh ko navjanwadi kranti ke baad bhi jat ke khilaf ke sangharsh ko jari rakhna hai aur iske kaun kaun se mudde hain, ye sare baaton ko bhi unhone rakha tha. Aur aakhri mein unka jo lekh tha वो था खैरलांजी पर. एंड आई वुड लाइक टू टॉक अबाउट खैरलांजी अ बिट बिकॉज आई थिंक इट्स वन ऑफ द थिंग्स मीना स्किप्ड. आई मीन शी डिडंट फोकस ऑन दैट. इट वाजंट दैट काइंड ऑफ अ बिग मैसेकर. बट बीइंग इन नागपुर आई वाज आल्सो वेरी इन्वॉल्वड इन द एजिटेशन. एंड व्हाट अनुराधा रोट वाज दैट द लेसन्स वी कैन लर्न फ्रॉम खैरलांजी, वन ऑफ देम इज दैट द पोलिटिकल पार्टीज एंड दिस इंक्लूड्स पार्टीज लाइक आरपीआई and BSP, their leadership did not give any importance to this significance to Kailanji. Mayawati came because it was the 50th anniversary of the conversion of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Aur Diksha Bhumi mein bahut bada karyakram hua, Mayawati ne wahan pe bhashan diya aur kuch koi jikr nahi kiya. Nobody talked about Kailanji. And then after 1 month, it was the women's organizations who took out the first प्रोसेशन. पहला मोर्चा महिला संगठनों ने, दलित महिलाओं ने निकाला भंडारा में और फिर वो आग लग गई. एंड देन दिस होल मूवमेंट स्प्रेड. एंड देन शी राइट्स दैट द अपराइजिंग ऑफ द डाउनट्रॉडन दलित्स, देयर मिलिटेंसी, वो मिलिटेंसी इतना हुआ कि इन द मीडिया द स्टेट हैड डन दिस प्रोपेगेंडा कि इसके पीछे नक्सलवादी हैं, व्हिच वाज नॉट ट्रू. इट वाज अ स्पॉन्टेनियस मिलिटेंसी ऑफ पुअर दलित्स. And they poured out into the streets, they attacked the police vehicles, they faced lathi charge, they landed up in hospitals, in the police stations. And this showed the caste nature of the police who entered into Dalit houses and said, who has a picture of Ambedkar in their house? Who has a statue of Buddha in their house? And in that way, as if keeping a statue of Buddha or a picture of Ambedkar is a crime or is something wrong, they started beating up people. When the civil liberties group like CPDR and Lokshai Hak Sangathan, PUCL and all, we went to all these Dalit areas and we saw the real nature of the state in the way they handled this. So Khairlanji was like a writing on the wall. Wo ek sanket tha ki ek atrocity ke baad jab garib Dalit aawaz uthate hai to leadership ko ye to nazarandaz nahi kar sakte. They have to take this into account. And then it became such a big issue ki uske bare mein fir pressure ke karan judgment kuch alag hua. In this case people logo ko saza mili, but not for scheduled caste, under scheduled caste atrocities act. इस जजमेंट का कास्ट नेचर नहीं था. इस जजमेंट में सिर्फ मर्डर करके सजा हुई. सो दो इट वॉज लिटिल डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द अदर जजमेंट्स, द कास्ट नेचर वॉज नॉट टेकन इन टू अकाउंट. एंड देन दिस वॉज अ टर्निंग पॉइंट फॉर द ट्रेंड विच द स्टेट स्टार्टेड, वेयर एवरी कास्ट एट्रोसिटी आफ्टर दैट इज इक्वेटेड टू अ पर्सनल एनिमिटी. उसके बाद अहमदनगर में जाओखेड़ा में जो हुआ उसको भी व्यक्तिगत लड़ाई करके बोला गया, वही प्रचार किया गया. फिर अभी हरियाणा में जो हुआ उसको भी व्यक्तिगत लड़ाई, यानी जब कोई दलित के ऊपर कोई अत्याचार हो रहा है आजकल, इसको व्यक्तिगत करके बोला जा रहा है, इसको कोई पर्सनल प्रॉब्लम करके बोला जा रहा है, इसका कास्ट नेचर नहीं बताया जा रहा है. ये मुझे लगता है थोड़ा खैरलांझी के बाद ये एक टर्निंग पॉइंट हुआ. बट ये खैरलांझी का जो आंदोलन था, ये लोगों को सच में बताया कि लोग स्पॉन्टेनियसली जब रस्ते में आते हैं तब वो क्लास, कास्ट और जेंडर तीनों का इंटरसेक्शन एज अ स्ट्रगलिंग फोर्स यहाँ पे सामने आया. बिकॉज एज आई सेड, इट वॉज वीमेन हु केम टू द फोरफ्रंट, वीमेन हु लेड द एजिटेशन इन द बिगिनिंग. इट वॉज द पुअर, द वर्किंग क्लास दलित्स हु केम टू द फोरफ्रंट एंड दे वर दलित्स. सो दीज, ये तीनों चीज जब साथ में आता है तब एक क्रांतिकारी बात बनती है, तब आंदोलन वो क्रांतिकारी दिशा में जाता है. एंड सर्टनली द पॉइंट्स, द होल स्पीच ऑफ व्हाट मीना सेड एंड व्हाट एवर शी पुट फॉरवर्ड हियर वेरी मच गोज अलॉन्ग विद द काइंड ऑफ राइटिंग्स व्हिच अनुराधा डिड. एंड आई एम वेरी ग्लैड दैट वी हैड मीना टुडे एज अ स्पीकर, बिकॉज इट सेट्स द राइट नोट फॉर द थिंग्स व्हिच आर हैपनिंग इन द कंट्री. The atrocities on the minorities, on women, on Dalits, which are growing day by day in the country. This needs the resistance of the people. Already a number of writers, artists, scientists have come out, whether they are returning awards, whether they are speaking out, whether it's students like those from the FTII who are struggling, or the students whose scholarships are being denied in the central universities who are now coming out and struggling. The struggles seem to be growing. And I'm sure there's going to be a momentum to this struggle, and people are going to make it clear that they are not going to take this lying down, and they are going to protest, and this protest will go on. So thank you so much for attending this. And I lastly end with a small appeal that our organization, the Anuradha Ghandi Memorial Committee, really is a non-funded organization. We don't take funds from the government. We don't take funds from any funding agency because we don't want to do our work according to what they dictate and what their views are. So it is totally on personal funding, and I'm appealing in the end to everybody to please chip in and give some contribution. Our treasurer, Suresh Rajeshwar, is sitting here next to Bernard. He's raised his hand. So please leave a small check or cash, whatever you have with you, for us. It's a registered organization with a bank account and everything. It's a registered trust. So please feel free to contribute and help us out. Thank you.
Thank you.